Hey guys, brand new podcast, and the Fully Loaded Tour kicks off next week, next Thursday, June 16th. We are in South Bend, Indiana, then Louisville, then we are in Dayton. South Bend and Dayton are both sold out. And by the way, I hate to say this, Louisville's almost sold out, as is Lawrenceville, Georgia. They're all selling out, so get your tickets now. We still have tickets available in Greenville, Bristol, and Brandon, Mississippi. And look, we always add tickets, so we always add seats. So go to FullyLoadedFestival.com. It's Dave Attell, me, Big J Orkerson, Shane Gillis, Nikki Glazer, Taylor Tomlinson, Sal Vulcano, Fortune Feebster, Dustin Nickerson, Aaron Weber, fucking Big J Orkerson, Sal Vulcano, Chelsea Lynn. I think I said them all. But go to FullyLoadedFestival.com and see if you can still get tickets. I'm dying to see you guys on the road. It's going to be the biggest party of the fucking year. And having said that, one of my favorite dudes in the world showed up. He's on the podcast. I want to make this short and sweet, so you go to YouTube and watch his special live at the Lodge Room. It is streaming right now on YouTube. He is absolutely hilarious. He's part of one of my favorite podcasts, Come Town. He is the fucking best, and we have a great podcast. My daughter Isla just walked in the room, and we're going to see a movie. Ladies and gentlemen, go to YouTube and watch his stand-up special live at the Lodge Room. My buddy, Stavi, baby. So I've been trying to get healthy.
Yeah.
And I
know all about, oh fuck, I was about to drink this candle.
We had a few parties.
Yeah.
So we drank all
graduation,
our
graduation, right? Congratulations.
Georgia,
that's awesome.
Georgia graduated high school. Dude,
That's huge.
It sucks. It sucks, man. Like I so badly just don't want her to grow up.
Yeah.
And there's no stopping it.
Yeah,
just
yeah.
It's just and we so
and we, high school's a big one too. It's like, you know, there's little cute milestones, but high school's like, damn, she's going to college. She's like, she is going to be on her own. That's the scary shit. You know?
So, like, full on her own. So we started on Friday. We had a baccalaureate mass and then a dinner at the school. No booze. And I'm like, great. Come home, fall asleep Friday night. Don't drink. Wake up.
I've
been checking my blood pressure because my blood pressure has been perfect.
Nice.
And, wake up, take my blood pressure. It's 120 over 70. I'm like, that's
beautiful,
ideal.
Dude. Yeah.
And
you're like an Asian 40-year-old woman.
Yeah.
Who does Pilates every day.
Yeah.
You're looking good.
I work out. I bust my ass.
Absolutely.
I walk on the beach with my friends.
Yeah, you're doing Tai Chi.
Yeah.
You've just started Tai Chi. It's like you'll do it till the end of your old lady Asian life, but this is the first year of it. Like, that's where you're at right now. That's awesome.
So, And then Leanne's like, we have a brunch, and then we have graduation, then we have a dinner. And then the next day, just so you know, we're going to take my dad to this is her schedule. We'll take my dad to the airport, and then we have another party for
damn.
Georgia.
Events on events.
Dude, I started drinking at our party, our brunch, and I did not stop until last night. Last night at dinner.
Yeah.
At dinner, I had my last glass of wine.
Okay.
And woke up this morning. Now, my blood pressure had been perfect. Woke up this morning, it was 160 over 110.
Damn.
And I'm like, motherfucker.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, like, I'm like, all right, I got to get it down. And I know that if I work out, it'll lower it, but so high. And so then I fucking
It sucks when you can tell your blood pressure is up when you're trying to exercise and your head feels like it's about to fucking explode.
Yes.
I'm in that because I've been on the road 9 months in a row. So it's like
the clip that went around, I don't know if it went around to non-podcast people, but like the clip that went around was like, I'm fucking tired of this shit. I'm done. I'm done. I love hearing like you and DeStefano are both the two people that have been
I love Chris.
And like you guys are both like, man, is it worth it? I mean, I'm fucking gone all the time. I'm sitting in my back going, bitch, I never spoke that out loud. I just sat and drank myself to death in airport bars. Like, I fucking.
Well, dude, that's what it is. Is like I have been living like it's just like 9 months of chicken tend. It's like, and it sounds so stupid to complain about because it's like, if it didn't destroy my body, it would be paradise. Because what we're talking about is the most delicious food you'll ever fucking have. Yeah. As much weed, you know, I'm growing up in a golden age of weed technology as a weed head.
Yeah.
I'm having weed, you know, tinctures. I don't even have to eat. I just put a little under my under my tongue and I'm high in like, you know, 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Just like eating like shit, drinking. You get to fuck strangers in different towns.
Yeah,
you get to try, you get to see all different styles of titties. You know what I mean? It's like, it really is awesome, but it's like, I am fat as shit. I'm back in the big and tall store. That's a tough one when you cross back into the big and tall store threshold.
Wait, were you out of it?
I was out, baby. I was out. I was in regular XLs. I've never seen an L. All I want in my life is no X in front of my shirt size, and I was close. Yeah. Like before this tour started, I could fit a generous large. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
I could fit an Old Navy large. You know,
Target large.
Yeah. I could do wherever poor people shop. I could do those big larges. Banana Republic large. We weren't even close.
I remember the first time I asked for a double XL, it was at Abercrombie and Fitch.
Oh.
And they told me, we don't do those.
They got disgusted, probably. Yeah. They're like, get the fuck. They called the police. They called mall security.
We don't do those.
A fat guy is trying to buy our clothes. Oh, right away. Right away, Aiden. We'll send them right up.
I'm always impressed by people who can do the road. And like Steve Byrne, before I toured with Steve, he could do the road. And he would be in the green room watching a documentary on his laptop. And then you'd be done. He was like, I'm going to finish this documentary in my room.
Wow.
And I'm like, I remember going, what the fuck?
You're not buzzing? You don't want to go destroy your fucking, you know, just level off a little bit?
It's crazy. I can't. I'll tell you how bad this is how bad my eating is. And I've been working out trying to lose weight. Yeah. And I lost a bunch of weight the first like week. And then it stayed like 254.
Yeah.
It stayed for like 5 fucking days. Yeah. And I just gave up.
You can't weigh every day though. You know that.
Oh.
You know you can't. That's not how it works.
Last night at dinner, there's food on my fucking pants.
Yeah.
Last night at dinner, I got 4 dishes.
Love that.
I got 4 dishes. I said, I want to try everything. My kids had gone to this place. They go like, Dad, we found this hole in the wall.
Love that.
Italian joint. They're like, the guy's great.
Yeah.
And the food's really good.
Yes.
So I told Leanne last night, I go, let's just go. The girls are all at parties. Let's me and you go.
Oh, it was just you and Leanne.
Just me and Leanne.
Okay.
And she was like, I think I'm going to get. And I was like,
this is not about you.
Yeah. I was like, hold on. I'm getting their carbonara. I'm getting their lasagna.
Yeah.
I'm getting their eggplant parm.
Absolutely.
And then what do you want? And she was like, but man, I fucked up food last night. God.
Dude, believe me, I'm there with you. I just released my special. So I was with, my favorite meal is probably Korean barbecue. Went to an all-you-can-eat Korean barbecue with my boy, my buddy who helped me. Like, he's working with me now to, like, he does all my social media. But it's like, we've been friends for like a decade. And he had just got off a job with Netflix. And I was like, dude, I can pay you. Not even close, but it will be the funnest job of all time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, we just hang out and he like does everything. So I was like, just me and him, we fucking fucked up Korean barbecue. I mean, I still have the meat sweats. I'm running a fever technically right now because all the calories my body is trying to, it's a furnace in here right now, dude. Like,
what's your favorite? Like Korean barbecue, I love Korean barbecue, but I get overwhelmed by it because I don't know.
I gotta take you.
I don't know how to do it.
Dude. Next time we both have some time, I'm taking you Korean barbecue.
Really?
Because I know there's special sauces you got to ask for.
Really?
Because they see white people and they're like, we're giving them bullshit.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's like we don't have to give them the good shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you have to advocate for yourself as a fat white man in a Korean barbecue restaurant. You know, you have to ask for the best dipping sauces are the bean paste and the sesame oil. Sesame oil is really expensive, so they don't put it out. You have to ask like it's a speakeasy.
Really?
And that shit is fucking awesome, dude. It's just like a little salt and sesame oil. And then you got all your banchans. You got to get a steamed egg. You want to get the galbi, the marinated rib. And it just depends where you go, right? Because like there's some places in New York, I'm much more familiar with that, even though LA is like fucking...
LA is
it's insane. We were in Koreatown and it was like, we picked a good one, but it was like you walk around the corner, there's an even better. It's just like insane.
Well, we went to the one... We went to one, our neighbors and like our best friends when we were just having babies.
Yeah.
Was a guy named Roy Choi who kind of created the taco truck thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He did Kogi.
Yes, which, yes. The fusion,
so,
yes.
Yeah. So him and his wife one night were like, we want to take you guys to Korean barbecue. And we're like, yeah. Best. They took us to a place that didn't have a sign on it.
Yes.
It was a big place, too.
Yeah.
It's on Wilshire. It's a white building.
Yeah.
There's no sign.
No, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's designed to keep white people out.
Yeah.
They don't want you there.
They don't want
you. And that's the more they don't want you there, the more of a colonizer you feel like. If you feel like the British Empire going into a fucking place for foreign people, that's where the food is fucking good. Same thing for every cuisine. Greek, too. Like in Astoria, it's like my favorite one. Like there's one that everybody knows about, but my favorite one off the strip, it's just called Gregory's, and it's just like little as shit. It's this. Two people run it, Gregory, who is the cook, and the waitress, who you're not sure if it's his sister or his wife.
Yeah.
And they hate each other. The waitress, this old horny Greek lady, who's just like flirting with everyone. Gregory's like rolling his eyes. You can hear them arguing in the back. He's got his shoulder hair out. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's what you want. You want the most authentic, the thing that would like drive, like, think of your most basic milk toast American. You know what I mean? Think of like a Massachusetts, like, you know, yuppie type of person, Connecticut. You want them uncomfortable.
Yeah.
That's where the fucking good ethnic cuisine is, for sure.
The more they hate white people, the better their food is.
Yes. And the best is, like, I was dating a Korean girl, and she took me to a place where, again, no sign.
Yeah.
She's ordering. They're looking.
Oh, there was no English. The woman that we went with Roy didn't speak English.
Yes, exactly.
And I'm like, you live in America. Like, how do you really don't speak any English?
It's awesome, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I tried to tell you something. She goes, no, nothing.
Yes.
And I went.
Yeah. The more it feels like a business shouldn't exist, the better the food is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, give me fucking, let me see an exposed wire in the ceiling. Like,
yeah.
I was in where was I? Minneapolis. Great ethnic food. They have like a big Hmong population, which is like sort of like Vietnamese stuff.
I remember learning my first what a Hmong was in Chicago. There was an Asian chick, and we were fucking around.
I
said something to her. So I've always been really good at knowing the ethnicity of Asian people.
Wow.
I don't know why.
Party trick.
Yeah.
A vaguely racist party trick.
Vaguely racist. So,
where you're like, I don't know if this is impressive or I should be on a like list somewhere, but
And I remember, and this is before Clint Eastwood's movie came out.
Yeah. Yes.
And I remember saying to her, I said, where are you from in Vietnam? And she goes, I'm not from Vietnam. And I went,
wow,
hold on. And she goes, no, I'm Hmong. And I go, okay, you just made some shit up.
I mean,
like, if we had a recording of that,
you're done.
I'm done.
This is good.
I was Hmong. I go, come up with a good one, okay? Hmong. That doesn't even fucking sound real.
Yeah.
And so,
that's incredible. So I was at this place, and it's a Vietnamese, like, place, and the soup was so fucking good. I was kind of sick under the weather.
Yeah.
And they had incredible, like, lemon, bum bo hoy, which is, like, the spicy pho.
You know a lot
about. Dude, I'm a food, Asian food guy, Greek food, whatever it is, I'm telling you.
I love food, but I don't know shit about it.
I love learning about it. And so here's how good this place is, right? And we can go back to how good food is, but just to tell you what this place was like, I'm crushing this soup. I'm like, it's so good. Packed place, right? Packed place. Yeah. A mouse runs through the whole place. Everyone looks at it. The staff looks at it and laughs. Everybody laughs and goes back to their soup. No one, like, everyone's like, oh, look at that cute little diseased rodent running around. We don't give a fuck. Everyone goes back to slurping. Because the waiter kind of laughed at it and looked at us like, what's up? You don't want the soup?
Yeah.
Like, we were like, no, sir. We love it. You know?
the best sandwich I've ever had in my life.
Ooh, I love
and
it.
And I think one time I pulled up the location on my map because I took pictures of it.
Yes.
In Vietnam, they make these egg sandwiches on the side of the road in a hot dog thing.
Yes.
But they make them for you.
Yeah.
The bread is so light.
Yes, that pillowy stuff.
It's so light, but like crisp on the outside. It held together so well. Two eggs, shredded pork, and hot sauce, but the right amount of hot sauce.
I know what you mean.
And I got one. My crew was loading a boat. We were going to Halong Bay.
Okay.
My crew was loading a boat, and I'm just walking around. And I was like, I don't go for a breakfast sandwich. So I grab one from her, and I took one bite, and I was like, this is the best.
Yeah.
I said, how much more bread do you have left? And I bought all of them. She made like 13 sandwiches.
You sent her children to like Vietnamese private school for 5 years.
It was the greatest fucking sandwich. And I brought them down to the boat and I said, I've never felt like this since.
Yeah.
I said, I want to see the look on your face when you try it.
Yeah.
And people bit in and they're like, motherfucker. And when we came back, I went and I got more sandwiches from her.
So sick.
And then I found out all the sandwiches that those women cook on the side of the road in Vietnam, all of them taste fucking amazing. There's something about, there's a show on Netflix called Broth.
Broth. I don't know about Broth. I'm in. Love that.
The best cooking shows on Netflix are not in English.
Yeah. Oh, interesting. You're right. Because I loved when they first came out with like, what was it, Chef's Table?
Yeah.
And that shit, because I was still living in Baltimore. I was just watching that all the time. That was my life. It was like, you know, trying to fuck a girl after an open mic and bring her home to my $300 a month room in Baltimore and being like, "What? Check out what this lady can do with fucking phyllo dough." You know what I mean? Like, isn't this an aphrodisiac? Let's watch this old Italian woman for hours of just fucking fold out pasta. Doesn't this make you horny?
I got onto this taco show. It was a Mexican food show that was really good. It was really, really good, but it wasn't in English. And I remember Leanne was like, "The fuck you watch? Are you reading about?"
Yeah, dude, that is a next level fat guy move.
Yeah,
I'm watching a food show with subtitles.
<It's> dude, like- the other day, I found Broth. Right, yeah. I think it's called United States of Broth. Not United States. World of Broth or something.
Yeah.
And motherfucker, it is. Did you find it? Broth, just like Broth Show Netflix.
Love it.
And they did one. A nation of broth.
That's
they did dude, one. I took.
Sign a, me up. Let I me get my passport.
Yeah. It was a whole octopus, ooh, a whole crab, and that was the soup with a bunch of seaweed in it. And
fuck, it was. Dude. I'm about to bust.
The food, and every broth is different.
Yeah.
They've got eight seasons. Yeah. Like they're it's. I'm so turned on by broth. Yeah. You know, it's like, do you remember when you first tried ramen dude, and you're like,
what the fuck?
Dude, what the fuck? I've been eating canned tomato soup.
What the fuck? Oh my God. When you taste a broth and you're like, there's levels to it, you're like, what the fuck is this? This is hot. This hot water tastes better than a fucking steak. How did you do it?
Oh, when you go into our best friends are Vietnamese and they make a broth, like they, every Saturday morning they start a broth.
Yeah.
And it's all fucking week. And their house smells like a broth.
Smells awesome.
Fucking awesome.
Just like fucking bones, lemongrass.
I saw something one time that I couldn't really wrap my head around it. I guess it would be like a guy living in the closet finally coming out and then having to come to terms with what his life was back.
Yes,
going home, right?
Yeah.
I saw Aziz Ansari and who's, I'm forgetting his name. He has the cooking show on Netflix.
David Chang. Okay.
David Chang. And by the way, can everyone just give me a round of applause for not using any ethnic identifier?
I can see it in your eyes.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, if you don't get it once, I'm going to be like, no, not Jon Favreau.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they were talking about, what it was like growing up a minority and having their mom make them food and then them bring the food to lunch and then kids make fun of their lunch.
Yeah.
And all I can think of when I heard that, I was like, well, I didn't have any.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't, our school is predominantly Cuban. Mm. So like Cuban food, that's all cooks made.
Right.
That's all anyone ate was, I mean, our cooks for our cafeteria were all Cuban, so like
that's awesome.
we'd have picadillo,
picadillo
was on Friday, roba vieja,
that's awesome.
Like everything was Cuban. Yeah. I mean, it's really kind of crazy when you think about. I just had Cuban food, and then Fridays was spaghetti.
Spaghetti.
Yeah, but, okay. But man, I would. That was the best to this day.
Sounds a lot better than the Baltimore City Public School lunches that we were getting served. These like little French bread pizzas you could use as a frisbee and shit like that.
Dude, yeah. It was so fucking good. And so I didn't really grow up around any Asian or Indian or East Indian food. Right. But the idea that I like, if I smell Korean food, if I smell Indian food, I go like, whoa, I'm eating today.
Yeah.
And Aziz grew up in South Carolina, I guess.
Right.
I mean, can you imagine bringing in vindaloo?
Yeah. Samosas. What are those little fucked up Indian hot pockets you're eating? You know what I mean? Like, they're like, get some wings.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a little bit, Greek food was like, my mom would try it a little bit, but it's like at the end of the day, I think she like, it was just easier. Like my Greek friends who like, my mom was also just so busy. So I never got, you know, but I wasn't really introduced to this world of cuisine. Cause it's like, we were just kind of like, you know, my mom made some Greek food or we just ate fucking like, I didn't have a taco until I was like 15.
Really?
I didn't have like the only ethnic food was Chinese, but it was like, you know, the like bulletproof window Chinese spots where it's like just fake, you know, not authentic. Had no idea what ramen was. And that's a big thing. I'm interested in like how, like you have kids and you know all about all this fucking great food stuff. To me, I'm almost like my child will not know real ramen exists until they are 16, 17. You know what I mean? I saw like a 4-year-old eating like a fucking, you know, tonkatsu, like fucking developed broth with a soft boiled egg. And I'm like, this is a fucking toddler. This fucking thing should know this exists.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, and it was like a little, you know, it was like a Brooklyn Park Slope, like probably rich little fucking white kid. And I was just like, even though, you know, I just feel like there's such, you need to grow up thinking ramen comes out of a fucking plastic bag and it's 50 cents a fucking pack.
Yeah.
That's what ramen has to be to you. Or otherwise you're probably insufferable. You know what I mean? Yeah, like a kid who knows about shit is like
my,
so annoying.
My girls, we're getting their hair done for graduation. This was like probably Wednesday or Thursday. And they're coming home and they're like, hey, we want ramen. Can you get ramen for us?
Yeah.
And so I was like, yeah. And my wife's father was here and he won't eat spaghetti. He doesn't, he likes butter on his spaghetti.
Yeah.
So like, he's not.
Don't bring tomatoes around me.
Yeah, he doesn't have a very developed palate. And he was like, well, I like ramen.
Yeah.
Do what?
Yeah.
And I said, well, I don't think it's the.
Yeah. It ain't top
It's not
ramen.
What you're thinking.
Yeah.
It's a little different. And he was like, well, I'll take it.
Yeah.
And then the second they saw it, I mean, they were like, what's that? And I was like, that's like, they were like, we like Chinese food. And they're like, yeah. If, as long as they got honey shrimp,
or honey chicken, yeah,
and I was like, it's not gonna be honey chicken,
like,
I want, and it's so hard to.
What he wants is chicken nuggets dipped in General Tso's sauce, and that's you know.
Ultimately because I've been my wife never she met her first Jewish person when she moved to New York. I mean, she didn't know anything about anyone.
That's fucking hilarious.
She was real. I mean, but. My girls have very developed palates because of our friends.
Yeah, totally.
Because our friend's grandma was just like, hey, I made pho, like homemade pho.
Yeah. Oh,
you'll eat it. Let me show you how to eat it.
Yes.
So now my girls love all that shit.
That's awesome.
And it's interesting to think.
But it feels different, right? It's like a marked difference, generational difference, where you're just like, damn, like that's like, it's just so funny. Because me and my parents, right, like, me and my dad, we have a huge cultural divide, right?
Because
he grew up in Athens in the fucking, you know, from the 50s through the, you know, he came to America in the 80s. And so it's just like, we don't like having, you know, like we used to play soccer, but it's like having to catch fucking sports. My dad doesn't give a fuck about American sports, you know? It's like we'd watch Greek national stuff, but it's like, and it's just like, so there's that big disconnect with us that's just, not only it's like language and culture and stuff, but it's like, even if you're in the same culture, it's like, if you do well in life, you're gonna raise kids that you found annoying when you were a kid. You know what I mean? It's like, your goal is to raise kids that have it so easy they'd annoy you as a 13-year-old. You know what I mean? You'd be like, those fucking bitches in their pho. That's how you would look at them. You know what I mean? It's like, and it's like, that's a weird thing to think about where it's like, you're raising fundamentally different kids than who you are. And it's a weird challenge that no one thinks about. You know what I mean?
I look at T.I., like T.I.'s kids.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like, it's funny. I don't support the negativity on fucking people's kids, obviously.
Yeah, I remember, don't cyberbully any celebrity children.
but his kids are clearly very wealthy children.
Exactly.
And they have not had the same struggle as, say, a Kodak Black.
Of course.
So when you hear Kodak Black shit on T.I.'s kids, you've got to realize that, like, those kids genetically have the DNA to succeed in the struggle. Their dad and their mom both did it, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So they've got that Oprah gene of like they can get out, they could lift themselves up.
What did Tiny do exactly? I'm sorry.
I don't know. Yeah. She's so fucking hot, though. Can I tell you, I'm in love with fucking...
with T.I.'s wife?
Nicki Minaj.
Oh, yeah.
Nicki Minaj and Cardi B.
Yeah.
Did you watch
Cardi B's unbelievable.
Have you seen Cardi B watch his ship sink?
I have not.
Can you type in Cardi B watching it? It's my favorite.
She's awesome.
Like, it's like...
she's the best. And
the same way you were about tacos.
Yeah,
Cardi B is about life experiences.
And she's like, what, 27? Like, that's the other thing. She's young. She blew up when she was like 24 or 23.
Okay,
something like
that. Is this it?
Damn, that's a sick spot, too.
Is that Offset?
Yes. That is her husband.
You can hear her accent and her laugh.
It's awesome.
Ding! It's a whole motherfucker. Oh my, it's sinking!
It's sinking!
Y'all did it! Y'all did it!
Respect.
Oh my God. You can't do nothing about it. There ain't no big boat that can save it.
That's fucking
wild. It's gone. It's gone.
There's
bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Yeah, that fucking rules. No, she's
oh my God, it's gone. Oh my God.
I would love to be.
That scream.
I would love to have been her agent when she started to experience things for the first time.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because her reactions are so genuine.
Well, they kind of figure that out, too. I think she's doing a show where it's like Cardi tries or something like that, and she does a bunch of different shit. I don't know. I see it all the time on, like, Instagram or something. But, yeah, she fucking rules. And
my favorite thing. Favorite thing is Al Jackson had this joke that I fucking loved. It wasn't even a joke. We were doing a podcast once. Yeah. And he was like, yeah, man, I want to do white people shit. Yeah. And I was like, what? He goes, as a black man, you're only allowed to do three things.
Yeah.
Go to the club, go to the court, hang out with your buddies.
Yeah, yeah.
And he goes, I want to go paddleboarding.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was like, I would fucking pay to watch.
Yeah.
Like, it's so, but I mean, you know, but no fish, network would ever fucking greenlight it.
Yeah. I mean, you couldn't brand it like black guys doing white guy stuff. You know, it's like you'd have to massage it a little bit. But I mean, I do think that is cool because it's like just fish out of water in general is one of the cool, like most entertaining tropes in history. You know, it's like going somewhere, being somewhere different, being somewhere a little uncomfortable or just like experiencing stuff for the first time. You're always going to get hilarious. I mean, because comedy is so about contrasts, right? Yeah. And it's like that's such a harsh divide. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, my first bar mitzvah was awesome. I was like, whoa, what the fuck is going on here?
Yeah.
I was like, these motherfuckers are going all out. You know? And I literally was like, Ma, can I get a bar mitzvah? These fucking guys brought in like $5,000. They had a fucking carving station. It was fucking awesome.
Dude, bar mitzvahs. I remember going to bar mitzvahs when I was a kid, and I was like, I wanted to be Jewish.
Yeah.
So I was like, those kids pull in loot. They're fucking walking it's out genius. With fucking $35,000.
Yeah, Greek people don't have any of that shit. We don't have like a confirmation. Our baptism is when we're like babies.
I've talked to you about this, but you got the thing where you throw the thing in the water and you got to catch it, right?
That's just a like Easter tradition for some people.
Yeah.
But it's not like a big, because you're Florida. They do it at Tarpon Springs, the Greek community. But no, we don't have like a, like it's so genius when a culture just puts in a money making thing for your like teen kid. I guess graduation is the closest thing where I kind of caked up for graduation when everyone thought I was going to have a real career. When everyone was like, wow, Stav's going to make us proud. He's going to go to law school. It's like, Turns out I'm going to talk about my penis for a living. I'm going to detail all my sexual disappointments and embarrassments, and I'm going to close the biggest thing I ever did. Like, that's the other thing, dude. So I just released this special. It came out. It's out now on YouTube. Go watch it. But I
can't wait to watch that.
Dude, thank you so much. Yeah,
you're one of the funniest fucking dudes.
I appreciate that,
consistently,
man.
One of the funniest dudes.
Thanks, man.
What's the name of the special?
It's called Live at the Lodge Room. I did it here in Highland Park at this old Masonic lodge. So it feels so awesome.
Can you pull it up? It's up right now?
It's up right now. But I was watching it. I did like a live chat and I did like a premiere because I wanted it to feel like an event, because the reality is it's like this special is as good as anything on Netflix, and I paid enough money so that it looks good and it feels like a real thing, right? Yeah. So I wanted it to feel like a premiere. So, and I had watched it a bunch when we were editing it, but you know, I'm working on a new hour. So all that material kind of left my brain. I watched it like, because I was in the chat, I was playing, and I was like, wow, my mother is watching this right now. And my closer is a 15-minute bit about a horrific threesome I had. And I'm talking about it in detail. And I'm like, my mom came to America. My parents came to America. And they're like, we're going to give our son a better life. And it's like, the most notable thing I've ever done in my career is closes on a story about not being able to get hard when I tried to fuck two strangers and then coming back later with so many illegal dick pills, I thought I was going to die while I fucked them. And then I get a text from my mom that's like, I'm so proud of you. And I'm like, thanks, mom. I hope you didn't watch too closely.
Guys, I can't wait to retire. No more dodging paparazzi, fighting off women, or having Segura ask me for jokes. But there's one bit of a wrinkle in my plan. The absolute collapse of the entire freaking financial market. Inflation is eating into savings. Portfolios are getting wiped out and people are sweating. Even the S&P is down over 16% right now. And hot shit stocks like Amazon are in the toilet. But look, I'm not as worried as most because I know about the billionaire's gambit. This ironclad asset has been a store of wealth for billionaires for centuries, because not only is it a natural inflation hedge, it's got insane price appreciation over time and extremely low correlations to those tanking stocks I mentioned earlier. So it checks two big boxes for a strong portfolio: diversification and low volatility. If you want to learn more about pulling off the billionaire's gambit yourself, I recommend visiting my friends over at Masterworks. You can get priority access to skip their waitlist by going to masterworks.art/Bert. See important Regulation A disclosures at masterworks.io/CD. That's masterworks.art/Bert. BetterHelp. I feel great right now.
So do I.
I feel great right now. And can I tell you that I accredit it to therapy?
So do I.
I honestly think it's funny. You know, you don't eat salt and you don't feel bloated. You go to therapy and you start feeling better.
That's right.
A lot of people feel burned out and they think that's work. So it can be. But man, sometimes you're not taking enough time for yourself. Have you ever felt burned out? Life can be overwhelming and many people are burned out without even knowing it. Lack of motivation, irritability, fatigue. We associate burnout with work, but that's not the only cause, because our lives can lead us to feel burned out. BetterHelp Online Therapy wants to remind you to prioritize yourself. Talking with someone can help you figure out what's causing you stress in your life. BetterHelp is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to, and I find that to be so great. Not only is it more affordable than in-person therapy, you can be matched with your therapist in under 48 hours. And by the way, I just got to say that doing it online or doing it on the phone when I'm on the treadmill, for me, takes out 90% of the stress of going to therapy. Our listeners can get 10% off their first month at betterhelp.com/Bert. That's betterhelp.com/Bert.
But, you know, what are you going to do? It's really funny to think about, you know, the sacrifices they've made and then like what you, and then everyone giving me that graduation money thinking I was going to go to, I went on scholarship to undergrad and I just never finished because I was doing comedy.
Where'd you go to school?
University of Maryland, Baltimore County. The Retrievers, they just won. We finally have a claim to fame. We were the first 16 seed to beat a 1 seed in the NCAA tournament.
Really?
That's the team that beat Virginia like 3 or 4 years ago. But it's a fucking shit school. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like I got there because it was the only school that gave me a free ride. And I didn't want to live at home, obviously. And so I lived, it was 15 minutes from where I grew up, but I lived in the dorms because I was like, I just want to be in the dorms.
Yeah, I miss the dorms.
Yeah, I miss
meeting new people, like that many new people.
Yeah.
There's something to be said for, like, I was telling Georgia, she's got some friends, and I said, don't room with one of your best friends.
Yeah.
Room with a stranger. Your best friend's there.
Yeah.
Like, go. Absolutely. Her best friend is going to school with her.
That's great.
A couple of her friends.
That's awesome.
And I was like, don't room with any of them. Everyone meet new friends.
I agree with that.
We met. I've talked about this before. I'm going to see just a little bit.
Yeah, it's a little snippet. It gets going pretty quick, so. Because that's the other thing. It's for the internet, so it's like, I didn't want a big, like, intro. I just wanted
By the way, for the record.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We got going right away.
That's how a special should start.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
it is always weird. It's like you do a comedy special and you're so good at stand up, right? And this was especially in the 80s and 90s. It's like you're the best at this. You're about to put out an hour of unassailable classic material. And then it's like, well, to start it, why don't you do a form of comedy you've never done in your life really quickly?
Yeah.
It's like a rock band before their album being like, why don't I play the bagpipes really shittily? Every time like a stand-up would do a sketch, it's like, why? Why are we doing this?
Yeah, it made no sense to me. When I did Secret Time, I had watched a bunch of, I watch a lot of specials.
Big moment in body positivity comedy branding, by the way, Bert, Secret Time. Let's not forget the shirtless. I loved it.
it starts pretty quick.
Yeah.
It starts pretty quick. Okay, I did a special before that, The Machine, where I was shirtless.
Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
And Showtime was like, hey, by the way, the lady at Showtime, I forget her name, but she was very cool. Yeah. I didn't remember her name. I'm not going to say it because I don't want her to.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
She was like, let's do one shirt with a shirt on.
Yeah, yeah,
and I was
well,
but then we can't really match the two.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She goes, yeah, but I have a note. And I said, what's that? And she goes, by taking your shirt off, you're giving people a reason to change the channel.
Well, the thing is, Bert, your disgusting, horrific body might turn off. We've tested it, and everyone ages 18 to 48 are against your flabby tits.
I was like, okay. But I just did them both shirtless, and she was right, man. It was like the lowest watched special I've ever made. It was the lowest. Like, I remember, I'll tell you the people that beat me, and you go, what?
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Like, and
yeah, there's
and
it was, some weird Showtime specials to begin with.
And
sure.
It was the lowest.
Wow.
And I remember getting in the ratings and going, like, I was like, no one, why? Like, the highest turnover off rate of anything. And I was like, fuck. And so then I was like, I'll just put it online.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
I thought it was good.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I actually, when I, so Leanne edits my specials because
sick.
I can't watch them. And she knows the material as well as
that's
I do.
So cool.
So Leanne, we go in together, we sit with an editor, and then Leanne will be like, she's just very brutal. She'll be like,
you need that.
Get it going. What are we waiting for?
Too much setup.
Yeah, too much setup. Do we have it? She murdered it on Hey Big Boy. She's like, we should watch the one edit. This is probably the best show I did. And she goes, is that mustard on your pants? She's like, God damn it, I told you not to eat a hot dog. You had 4 hot dogs before you went on, and you had mustard on your fucking pants. And so, but there was one chunk, I think it's about part of my gun chunk, my dogs.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, enough already, boo Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
Yeah.
This is long as shit.
Yeah.
Do we have a shorter version of this? And for whatever reason, I was having fun in that one, so
yeah,
I was fucking around.
Course.
And there was a version of that joke that was a minute 30 shorter.
Wow.
And she was like, put that one in.
Wow.
And so, like, for Leanne, when Leanne watches a special, it's all about, because I can't watch the intro, the beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
All that makes me, but then once we get into, like, the first bit, every time I can tell if a special is good of mine, because I start smiling and nodding and going through and saying the bit in unison.
Right, right, right.
I go, okay, we got it.
Yeah.
But then
yeah,
there's
yeah.
times where, like, I'm on Hey Big Boy, I was like, The intro was, I couldn't get the intro right. I couldn't get the opening joke right.
But dude, it's so, that's the other thing is like, that's something I learned with this. It's like, you know, especially when you're like coming up in comedy and you're a shitty open micer and you're like, oh, that sucked. And then you do a special and you're like, well, to get this cool venue and to get this crew, I had to do a Monday 6 p.m. show and a Monday 8:30 show. And it's like, no one's really ready for comedy. And then it's like, you're not nervous. By the time you do a special, no show phases you, right? Like, put me on, right? Like, you could fucking put a fucking, you know, kidnap me Taliban style and just unload me at a comedy club and be like, go do an hour. I could do it. It would not be hard at all. I wouldn't be nervous. But then when you record something for the first time, it's kind of like the nerves come back because it matters. You're scared because this is different than a regular show.
Yeah.
And you might be the best comic in the world at a regular show, but if you don't have any reps on a recorded thing that matters, which, to be honest, I really didn't. Like, I record every show just to, when we find the special moments, I put them online. But there was never something where it's like, okay, well, you're spending $40,000. And if you bomb, you just lost all that money.
Yeah.
So you're kind of shit, and you don't realize, like, that shit is fucking hard, and you only get two cracks at it, usually. And if you kind of, and, you know, there's jokes in there that are not the best versions of the jokes that I honed, you know? And it's like, you learn that shit, and then you learn the editing, too, where you're saying, where you're like, you love it. You're like, wow, that was my favorite part of the special. And then you watch it with an editor who doesn't give a fuck about your feelings. They're like, that sucked. Cut that. You're like, what? That's my child, you know?
Yeah.
And it's but you have to be brutal and you have to edit and you have to, you know, make it feel awesome for this audience, you know?
I think it's so cool. People are putting specials up on YouTube. Before Secret Time, cause I didn't know if I was going to get a Netflix special. I was like, I think I'll just put them on YouTube. Because I was having a lot of success on YouTube.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was having a lot of success on Facebook and on YouTube, and it was selling tickets for me.
Exactly.
Like when we did, you know, the machine, I put all of it on Facebook.
Yeah.
And I put they were like, you can upload like four clips. And I put four clips, and in total, I think it was 45 minutes worth of material. And they were like, that's not what we meant. But the machine story went viral, and I started selling tickets. Yeah. And I was like, well, fuck, that's the goal.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I wanted to do an hour at Netflix, and they weren't giving it to me, and I was like, I'll just put it on YouTube.
Yeah.
And I remember everyone being like, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Yeah.
And then I think it was probably, I'm guessing the people that, Comedy Central started putting hours on YouTube.
Yeah, I mean, yes, Mark Norman might have been the first one. I mean, Sam Morril was really early on. I mean, I remember talking with Sam. I mean, me and Sam do a podcast, one of my best friends. And he was like, what the fuck? And he was like, because he had specials by that point. And Sam's one of the funniest guys in the fucking world. And he was just like, what the fuck is it going to take for one of these streamers to put it up? And he was just like, I think he was the first one because people did it with Comedy Central. But Sam, I think, put it on his YouTube channel. And that kind of started everything because he's like, yeah, I'm getting these subscribers. Like, and it's like, yeah, you know, Comedy Central or a bigger channel, they might have 2 million subscribers, but the success, and maybe initially you'll get more views that way, but the lasting success where you'll get fans that will stick with you, that happens if you do it on completely on your own. And I think obviously shit's gone great, right? But it's like, I think you would have been, you know, really well served doing it with YouTube too, you know?
I think so. I mean, I probably wouldn't have put as much money into it as people are putting in now.
Yeah.
That was the difference.
You wouldn't have had to, though, because the novelty of putting a special out on, like, I felt like I had to spend a little more money because now there are a lot of them out there, and you just want to feel, and I also, like, I didn't want it to feel like I was settling for a YouTube special. I wanted, which is the truth. I didn't settle for this. This is how I want it to be, right? Like, because there's a difference. You know, sometimes you just put something out there, but I was like, fuck it. Let's bet on ourselves here. Let's make it look like a real one because it's a little saturated. So you want it to look different. But at the time, a comic where, you know, of your stature, putting something out on YouTube, it would have been like, whoa, you wouldn't have had to spend, you know, you would have just cut a cool, maybe like 10, 20 grand. It would have been fucking awesome.
I remember technology just took off. Like, I remember Rogan being like, yeah, you gotta put video up on your podcast.
Yeah.
And I was like, ah.
That was when that first started happening. I was like, what? I have to worry about how I dress? the fuck? I look like shit. I live in a windowless room in Queens. I live off of eggs and beans. I look like shit. I live off halal cart. I don't want my face out there. This is fucking bullshit. But yeah, they were right. Obviously, Rogan was right.
Yeah, you know? And I remember Segura. I remember seeing Segura. Like, I went and he had like a full, they bought like kind of like a warehouse. And yeah. He was doing it out of a warehouse. And I was like, or like an office building, but it was
right,
huge.
Right.
And I was like, motherfucker.
Yeah, this was supposed to be easy.
And now you go to Skurs and he's got like 12 employees.
Yeah.
And you're just like,
I mean, I love this setup. You got it. Fuck it.
I like this setup, dude, because it's easy for me. Like, I just literally was sound asleep.
Yeah.
I slept through a fucking production call. Like, I had a production call. That's at awesome. 10, and then my assistant was like, hey, you have a call in 10 minutes. So I said, all right, I'm going to close my eyes for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I woke up and it is an hour later. And I'm like, I guess.
Love those naps when you wake up scared like a baby. You're like, what the fuck's going on?
I'm
going to
take another one today.
Yeah.
Like, dude. I'm
you got to sleep that Italian food off.
Oh.
You got to sleep that linguine off.
I get so drunk and I over tip like crazy.
That's
like
not bad, though. That's a cool vice to have.
Yeah.
Over tipping. You look like the man. It's a lot better than getting drunk and like taking an upper decker in every restaurant you go to. You know what I mean? Like, all things considered, you know, it's like, that's at least they're like, but you know,
I'm waiting for the day that someone because you see those articles where it's so weird what articles I get delivered. Today, the article I got on my phone and it was Jonah Hill's quitting smoking. And I was like, what did I Google?
I don't give Shout out to Jonah. Yeah. Good for him. But why is this an article?
Dude, Jonah Hill is one of my favorite dudes.
Oh, he's the king, dude. He rules. And it's like, for me, it's like, that guy is like, he's the blueprint. I mean, I was in high school, senior high school, when fucking Superbad came out.
Oh.
And it's like, that's the, and like, obviously I had other influences. It's so funny, like how, like, when people make fun of representation, I think it's wrong because it's true, dude. Like, I was just a little fat kid who was kind of funny. And when I saw fat guys on TV being funny, I gravitated towards that. So it makes sense that you should put all kinds of people, because it does make a huge difference. But like, you know, and it was like, they were, you know, there were other fat guys, obviously John Candy, Chris Farley, all that stuff. But then it's like, when somebody lines up so perfectly and you are literally a guy who does not get pussy in his senior year of high school, and a movie comes out about a fat kid, a charismatic fat guy, just trying to get pussy before college. And I was like, that's literally it could not have come at a better time.
Yeah.
So, I mean, and then I just like, I love what he's doing with his life. And he's just out there surfing.
I love the Scorsese
movie. Like, he's done everything his career rocks. And now he's just fucking surfing, doesn't give a fuck. Like, you know what I mean? Just does whatever he wants, has his own fucking production company. He'll make whatever he wants. Shows up on a huge Netflix movie, is fucking sleepwalks through it probably, and is so funny. I mean, funny. I mean, the I can't believe I'm blanking on the
Don't Look Up.
Don't Look Up, which I fucking loved. I thought it was sick. He was fucking hysterical.
Dude,
you can tell he's just got it. Like, I mean, that guy fucking rules.
He is.
And I'm glad he's quitting smoking, even though you shouldn't have gotten that article.
Yeah. I love the low-key jabs he's gotten that they show. Like, I love that he went out to do Kimmel, and Kimmel goes, you smell good. That's surprising.
The fuck is that?
Yeah, and Jonah Hill's like, he's like, thanks? Like, and I love that he's like, hey guys, I really appreciate that you want to tell me I look good.
Yeah.
But how about don't?
Totally. Because
I don't want to make it a thing.
100%.
And you're like, yeah, I understand that.
Yeah.
It's like fun when you lose weight and everyone's like, God, you look good. But then.
Then it's like, well, what's the implication there?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You fucking pieces of shit. It's like, I'm cute no matter what's going on. You fucking cunts.
He's so fucking funny too.
Oh yeah, dude.
Like, one of my favorite scenes is that scene in War Dogs.
Oh yeah,
when he goes to buy weed from those black guys.
I haven't seen War Dogs in a while.
And he
it's great. A little
gives him $150
gem.
Bucks, and he's like, "All right, how about we get just an ounce?" And he goes, "All right," and takes his money, and then they just start talking. And he goes, "What the fuck?" And
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Do you know this guy? And he's like, "Okay." And so he goes goes and gets his machine gun and just starts
so
yeah. Where are you guys going? Oh, it's so fucking
so
great.
Funny and a great actor. I mean, Moneyball was fucking sick. And just honestly, Wolf of Wall Street is just like, he crushed that so much. Just that scene where he's talking about how him and his wife are cousins and the kid, they might have a retarded. I mean, just like the way he plays that is so fucking. I mean, just.
So yeah. I when
the
I
the king
when I did the movie, I never give a fuck about acting. I just it wasn't on my radar of like shit I cared about. And then when I did the movie, I was like, okay, I want to do a movie with Jonah Hill. Oh, I want to see how he works,
dude. That would be sick.
I think he does it different than other people.
Probably. I mean, it's interesting. All great actors, it's like it's such a, like, acting is so fucking weird because it's like comedy is cool because it's like no one can tell you how to do it. You just kind of have to figure it out. There's no school. There's no class. But acting, it's like, it's just like so, like, in anything I've ever acted in, the difference between nailing it and not nailing or doing what I want to do and not doing it feels so like minute and like in your head. And it's just like, it's so fucking hard to really be good at it that it's fascinating to just like watch how, and then it's like, and then sometimes, you know, the great method actors, they're just like, you really just don't break character and that's how you do it. That seems crazy to me.
I couldn't do that.
Yeah, I couldn't. Yeah.
I mean, when you hear of the, like, Daniel Day-Lewis.
Crazy. Yeah.
I mean, he's got to be exhausting as a friend.
Oh, my God.
Like, you got to be
Yeah. It's like, oh, all right, man, we have to have this 18th century stew for lunch again because you're playing a cobbler in Ireland right around the fucking potato famine. So we have to eat leather stew, leather
boot. I was thinking about Leonardo DiCaprio because I was like, he doesn't strike me as like, I don't know the right way to say this. I don't want to shit on him, I like him.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, he doesn't.
Another fucking.
He strikes me as awesome, like a very, still very young, maybe somewhat sheltered Hollywood celebrity, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, but all we see him is as like moguls and fucking like the characters he plays probably aren't similar to who he really is, right?
Interesting, yeah.
And so I was like, I bet that would bum you out. Like, if you like got on set and he was still this, like, I don't want to say spoiled, but like a sheltered Hollywood celebrity.
Yeah. It's so hard to tell with a guy like that because it's like, we really don't know. He's famous in that classic sense where he's one of the last few, like, old school famous guys. Like, celebrities now, it's like, they're live streaming, they're tweeting, they're TikToking, they're doing fucking everything. That's a guy who fucking shows up, crushes a movie, works with the best directors, and every like 6 months we hear that he traded in his girlfriend for a new 24-year-old. Like, that's all you hear about Leonardo DiCaprio. He's in a villa somewhere. We don't know shit. So it's like, who even knows what the fuck that guy's like? And I guess he did grow up, like, he is like, you know, child star and just been a star the whole way. So who knows? You're probably right. But it's like, he's mysterious where it's like, even someone like, you know, Will Smith, even before the whole Oscar shit, it's like, he even kind of started like doing content.
He leaned into the content.
Yeah, yeah.
And I would argue he wasn't ready for it.
He shouldn't have done it. He should have stayed. He had a pass. You're Will Smith. You don't have, this sucks dick.
Just hold
TikTok
on.
TikTok sucks.
Just wait until the next fucking big movie offer.
Yes.
Yeah. It's funny because in comedy, there's only like a couple dudes that really have held on to their privacy. And
right.
Tosh is one of them.
Yeah. Tosh, yeah, that's true.
Never has no social media presence.
Good for him.
He has no podcast, never been on a podcast.
Yeah. And, wow, and really?
Never been on a podcast.
That's crazy.
I've never seen him on a podcast.
Yeah, you're probably right. Now that you're saying it, I don't think I've ever.
No. And he's, and I mean, I think there's probably compromises. I'm sure that, you know, he probably has had ebbs and flows in his career.
Yeah.
But he's got all he cares about. He doesn't want anyone to know anything about him.
Yeah.
He's always been like that.
Yeah.
And he'll never hear this. Like, he's not listening.
Yeah.
Like, that's the other, like, he doesn't give a fuck.
That rules.
He's got tons of money.
Yeah.
He's got a huge fucking house in Malibu.
That's it, dude. That's all you want. Yeah, that's the dream.
Yeah.
The dream is to be so successful, we don't have to do any of this bullshit. You know, just like, do your one project a year that you love, fucking, and that's the thing, like, even like rich people, it's like the billionaire, I don't respect any billionaire whose name I know. You know what I mean? It's like being a fucking villa on an island. God. Anyone with less than $10 million isn't allowed on. Why are you going to space? And why do you want you? Why are you buying Twitter? Just enjoy having a fucking more money than God.
Yeah.
And just fucking have like fucking, you know, the most decadent breakfasts served to you every day.
What if the whole country of Greece finds this special?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And your ad sales for this,
you make like
$40 million off this. The whole island of Greece.
Oh my God.
And dude. You can go and do, you can do like 6 shows in Greece and walk with like $20 million. Yeah. And so you have a year where you got the fucking, you're just top of the fucking, could you do your whole set in Greek?
I couldn't. I could do parts of it. I can speak Greek, but it's like comedy is so like dependent on just like, it's not just the language, it's also the vibe and the, you understand. I mean, you know, you understand how comedy is where it's like.
But I don't understand it in different languages. Cause I remember Segura were going like, yeah, I do it in Spanish, but it's not the same. And it's, I was like, oh, you got to be more sexist and homophobic.
You got to wear a big dress. You got to wear a dress and with a midget that's trying to rape a woman.
You have to dress as a bumblebee.
Yeah, and then put a pie in a clown's face. And that's your big closer. It's so different because it's also like, because it's hard because it's like somebody who's a comedian or anybody, it's like our talent is like talking, right?
Yeah.
So like my fluency in Greek is like, it's like I'm a dumb sixth grader, you know what I mean? Or like a dumb seventh grader where it's like, you can talk with a dumb 13-year-old, but it's like, he's not quick. He doesn't know. And it's like, it's really frustrating because it's like, you'll be talking to someone and you'll have just something awesome, but it's in English.
Yeah.
And then you try, by the time you try and do a clumsy translation, because that's still where I am. I'm still translating. Like, I do think in English, especially when you're being funny or you're trying to be like, you know, whatever. So I want to try it. I'm going to go to Athens. Part of my, like, I'm trying to go on a huge 2023 tour because like
You're done touring right now.
I'm taking the next 3 months completely off. And then I'm doing one weekend a month for the fall because.
Really?
Because I just like, which business-wise makes no sense. None. Like, I like zero, right? Yeah. Like, because I could have it, because my numbers have just been going really, just like, I've been really working hard on my career the last 9 months. But the trade-off is like, you know, I literally have gained 60 pounds. And it's like, I want to, you know, I want to take the next half year to prepare myself for whatever comes the next 5 years of my career.
Important. And I never did this. I've never done this.
Yeah.
It's so important to have balance. Like when I'm home for just a little bit, my internal I wouldn't say clock, but my internal like gauge just starts leveling out. Like everything feels better and everything's right. And I'm, you know, totally, like yesterday the girls were sitting in the kitchen with Leanne and me and we're all bullshitting. And I thought, if you're home for 2 days, there's such an immediacy that you don't really get you don't catch all the small moments.
Right.
And so I I don't have that luxury because like Leanne forced me to take 3 months off.
Good.
she was, and man, I think I told her once a girl, I got offered a private gig.
Yeah.
For so much fucking money. So much money and a private jet back and forth.
Oh my God.
And she was like, nope.
Wow.
Edit this out. For one show. For one fucking show.
You're going to be like, I'm going to go play poker with the guys, honey. And you just take the private jet back and forth.
And then, by the way, there's like...
You're like, I won big.
Yeah. That's like... But she was like, she wants me to be...
I get that, though. That's the principle of it, right?
Yeah, that's like, the whole thing.
Either you're doing it or you're not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so the caveat she's letting me
That's tough.
She's letting me do Fully Loaded.
Yeah.
So I'm doing that for two
weeks. Which I'm so sad, dude. The fucking weekend. I want to do it. I'm in Philly. It's the last... That's the last thing of my tour.
Oh, you were the first... So you were the... Just so you know. So like we, when you book it, you get... some big names.
Yeah,
big names. The very first name I asked for was Attell. That was the very first.
The best. Yoda.
Yeah. I said, I want a tell. I said, get me a tell, and then everyone else will file it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I had a big list, and I remember your name was the first name that I said that was like, that I go, we have this whole list, and then I go, hey, can we get Stavros?
Yeah.
And they're like, hold on, let me check. And dude. And so we went out to, there's a couple people like that. There's a couple
heart.
People that I really, really wanted just because it would be fun.
And that's the thing. It's like, you look at those lineups and it's like, that's one thing that sucks about comedy is like, we're alone. We're headlining. And it's like, you lose that camaraderie of like the early years of stand-up. At least I had a cool scene. Like DC, you know, my scene was a lot of people are like, you know, still working, doing a lot of stuff. And you lose that camaraderie. And then especially the fucking, those lineups are so sick that it's just like, I would just want to sit there and not say anything. You know what I mean? Oh, I just want to like soak in that kind of talent. And those like, I mean, you're talking about those names on the list. It's like heroes. Attell especially is like the fucking, when Attell is around, it's just like, wow. It's just like, you feel like this is the fucking guy.
Oh, I just want him to watch my new hour. Tell me if it's any good.
Yeah.
It's interesting too, because I bet there's a way to do this tour differently, but I didn't think that way. Like, there's only a couple people on this tour that are like into social media, oddly enough. Attell's 100% not into social media.
And he shouldn't have to be.
Joey's 100% not into social media.
Yeah.
And so the marketing has been landing squarely on my shoulders to promote it. And almost it's been a very interesting. I think we sold out three shows.
Sick.
So, and by the way, they're like 12,000 seaters. Insane.
And I bet even though it's like it's on your shoulders, it's like those names. Just having those names on there.
Having those names, I'm gonna lean into them this week because we have our southern markets are I think every the front ones like Indianapolis is sold out. The first four. I think are all sold out. Maybe there might be tickets in Rochester still available. Maybe Louisville, but the bottom four, Lawrenceville is almost sold out. But I need to really do a push in the southern states.
Yeah.
But it's funny. I thought to myself, I didn't think. I just took the best comics.
Of course.
Let's
get a TikToker on there.
Yeah, if you got one TikToker, you'd fucking sell out in a heartbeat. And I thought to myself, there's two ways to do this.
Where you
could totally fucking.
Yeah.
And then I was like, and it's so funny because then it starts being on the other side of the business where you go, where you watch from the outside looking in people and how they're running their careers.
Then
how they're behaving. I had a conversation with Segura about it, and I said, I think I know why you're successful. And he was like, tell me.
And then
he came back and he goes, I'll tell you why I'm successful. I'm not a pain in the ass.
He goes,
I say yes to a lot of things.
Right.
And if I say no, I know what I'm good at and I know what I'm not good at.
Right.
But
being a good hang is one of the most important things in any fucking industry. It's like you just want to fucking be around someone that's like all you know, just a good time.
I think
when me and Bobby Kelly first started working together, literally, I took him to Korean barbecue when he was in Baltimore, and that was the beginning of our relationship. And
the way to Bobby Kelly's heart.
Yeah, he could tell. I've told this story on his podcast before, but he literally saw me, and I was about the size I am now. I was going through it in Baltimore as well, and he just looked at me and was like, you, where do I eat? And I was like, I'll tell you, sir. And then I was petrified. I'm a fucking, you know, I'm a 23, 24-year-old open micer. You know, I'm featuring whatever in Baltimore at the time. Yeah. But it's like, you know, this is fucking Bobby. You know, it's like this is one of the guys I grew up watching. And I'm just like so nervous and just like, you know, just like I hope he likes it. You know, I'm driving in my shitty Honda Civic. The defogger doesn't work. It's raining. Bobby's like, am I going to die with this fucking fat
Bobby?
This fat kid.
Bobby's such a good actor, too.
An insanely good actor.
He's such a good actor. He's in Joe List's new movie.
Yeah.
And it just his little line is like fucking, he's so seamless.
Dude, he's so good. I mean, getting to open for him for years was so like, comedy is just so, like we were talking about, it's like you can't teach it plain, but you can, if you love it and you observe it, you'll pick stuff up.
Yeah.
And with Bobby, it was so interesting because it's just like no one controls a room like Bobby.
No.
It's like you could put him in a room of no one knows who he is. I mean, he is obviously has a ton of fans, but you could put him in a room of strangers, which is like, honestly, is not the case for even like some of the best comics. Cause once you get to a certain level, you perform to people who adore you, and the best comics have the you know, they hold themselves to high enough standards that they stay good. But you could put Bobby anywhere and he will level it no matter fucking what. And there is an intangible quality to his energy that it was like I credit Bobby for so much of just like what I learned about stand up because I was, when we started working together, I was just a really just kind of like set up punch, just like a little mechanical, didn't, my personality was starting to peak out, but it wasn't like, and just seeing how Bobby just fucking controlled it. And I was just like, how, I was just like, not how as in like, why? Because I understood it. I was laughing, but I was just like, literally mechanically how, like,
yeah.
How do I recreate this? How? And I was fucking banging my head against the wall. Cause it's like, part of it is he's just a special talent that like, you can't recreate that. But part of it was just like, you just unconsciously and subconsciously, you try different stuff and you try and like, and I think honestly, it's like just trying to copy Bobby's energy, not even his jokes, his energy. Just if you know, being a cheap knockoff of Bobby's energy, you'll be one of the best comics in the world if you can figure that out, because that's how good he is. So yeah. It's just like, it's so, that's what's so
quick,
cool.
He's so quick and he can talk funny. Like he doesn't.
Yeah.
He
yeah. Yes. Yes. Funny. Yes. His like to mix like some new agey bullshit. His aura, like Bobby has a fucking power and aura that's like that exists personally, and then it's just like magnified on stage.
I think the best comics are like super sensitive.
Absolutely.
Like I'm very very sensitive.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm also oblivious. So I step all over toes,
yeah,
not
yeah.
realizing I'm fucking people up. And then if you just step on mine lightly, I'm yeah. like, what the fuck? Why would you do that to me?
Yeah.
Gentlemen, Father's Day is around the corner, and our friends at Manscaped are here to ensure that all the father figures out there are looking daddy material this June. Manscaped Performance Package 4.0, which includes their signature lawnmower 4.0, which is fucking awesome, is a perfect bundle to tackle any and all old man hairs from head to toe. This right here is no dad joke. Treat him and yourself and join the 4 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer. Get 20% off plus free shipping with the code BERT at manscaped.com. Trust me, this dad bod will thank you. Manscaped is designed with fathers in mind, and the perfect package 4.0 is perfect for pops. Inside, he's going to find their lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, weed whacker, ears and nose and hair trimmer, which is every dad's bane of existence. My daughters sit next to me in the car and all they do is look at my ear hair and tell me how gross I am. But not anymore. You know why? I trim the shit out of that. Does your dad have ear hair? Their fourth generation trimmer features a cutting edge ceramic blade to reduce grooming accidents. Thanks to their advanced skin-safe technology, their lawnmower 4.0 is waterproof and also has a 400K LED. That spotlight, it's a spotlight, and it's perfect for the precise shave. For me, I shave my balls over the sink or over the toilet. Not over the sink. Ooh, don't let Leanne hear that. I shave them over the toilet, and the toilet's not lit, so I need that light to know what I'm shaving. With this summer just around the corner, the Boxer 2.0s are here to save the day for every father in this uncomfortable heat. I'm telling you right now, whether he's mowing the lawn, taking out the trash, or golfing in the sun, these moisture-wicking boxers breathe without breaking a sweat. Get 20% off plus free shipping with the code BERT at manscaped.com. That's 20% off with free shipping at manscaped.com and use the code BERT. Shake what your mama gave you. Nah, shake what your daddy gave you. Sunglass season is here. So is Fully Loaded. We were just talking about Shady Rays. Leanne literally called today and she goes, hey, we need to get Shady Rays for all the comics that are on that thing. Because Shady Rays are fucking awesome. They're an independent sunglass company that offers a world-class product that is just as good as any of the pair of expensive glasses that you've ever worn. But they have durable frames, extremely clear, polarized lenses, perfect for living outdoors or doing shows outdoors at ballparks and beyond. That's not all. Shady Rays offers the most insane protection in all of eyewear. Every pair is backed by their lost and broken replacements. If you lose or break your pair, or even on day one, if you do that, they said to us they're going to send you a brand new pair, no questions asked. Get as crazy as you want this summer, but make sure to wear your Shady Raids and wear them with confidence. They also provide 10 meals to fight hunger in America with every order and have donated over 20 million meals to date. Look good in your Shady Rays and feel good by knowing that you're making an impact. If you don't love them, exchange them for a new pair or return them for free within 30 days. No risk when you're shopping at Shady Rays. Their team always has your back. I love my Shady Rays. I have pairs all over the place because I know that if they look at Halston's putting on his right now. He bought them for his wedding pictures, his engagement pictures.
Engagement shoots, what do you think?
You look good, buddy.
Thank you.
You look like you could be a Top Gun Maverick. Exclusively for our listeners, Shady Rays is giving you their best deal of the season. Go to ShadyRays.com and use the code BERT for 50% off 2+ pairs of polarized sunglasses. Try for yourself the shades rated 5 stars by over 200,000 people. But Bobby's very, very sensitive.
Yeah. But it's also about connection. I mean, everyone has like their cool shit, but sensitivity is so big. And just like, I mean, connection is just like likability. That's, I mean, one of your superpowers, one of the most likable guys. Instantly you get on the fucking, you get on the stage and it's like, it was so cool. The Jersey to just like watch you in that big room. Cause it's like people are fucking, they like, that's so important for comedy. They're fucking rooting for you. They're like, you're their guy, you're their friend. And it's like, well, and that's another intangible, just like, you either have that shit or you don't, and then you can cultivate it, and you've done really well cultivating it.
That's like, one of the things I didn't learn until well, I guess at the right time. It was, I had a fan come and tell me that that he was like, hey man, I don't have a lot of shit going on in my life. You know, I love your podcast and I love you, and when you succeed, I feel like I succeed because I picked you.
And I was like,
that's pretty fucking cool. And he goes, yeah, man, like, I'm not into sports. Like, I'm into comedy. Right, so when I watch you go and do bigger things, like, I get excited for you.
Yeah.
And so that was like a real big thing for me to note, to realize, because I'm like that also. Like, I get into shit. Like, Rogan is totally one of my closest friends. But I'm, first and foremost, I'm a fan of his.
Yeah.
Like, and so, like, I...
Oh, and that's got to feel incredible. That's got to, like, I'm a fan of Giannis Antetokounmpo, right?
Yeah.
Who was like, he comes into the league and he's just like this skinny kid that like no one really knows what to make of. And now 8 years later, he's the best player in the NBA. That's what it's got to feel like to be a fan of Rogan from early. Because it's like, he's the fucking, he's in and of himself, he's more influential than like most traditional forms of media.
Oh, I remember preaching to the choirs about how talented Joe was. And how big, how great his podcast was, and just how his brain works, and I remember doing that to people that were like, "You mean the Fear Factor guy?"
Yeah.
And you're
well,
like,
"Well, he's had one of the fucking coolest, weirdest careers."
Weirdest.
Like, I literally, this is the first way I knew about Joe Rogan was in Greece, on my, because my family would, we would go with summers in Greece, but
yeah,
not, don't get me wrong, it wasn't summering. It was like we lived with our fucking my aunt, and we lived in that. It was like me and my entire family in a fucking one bedroom, just like, you know, hot. It's Athens. We would only go to the beach for like 2 weeks, but we were in Athens for like 3 weeks. So we basically traded Baltimore for Athens. So we spent a lot of time just like living our normal lives, like what we would do in Baltimore. And so you watched a lot of TV, and fucking, I learned about Joe Rogan from news radio. Like, I was like his career is like, he's almost like Forrest Gump in a way, where it's just like fucking,
his career,
he shows
fucking
up
bizarre.
everywhere.
Yeah.
But that is, you know, that's also not a coincidence, because it's like, there's a reason he was getting those opportunities, you know? It's like, there was something people were picking up on, and, you know, and it's definitely, whatever that is, has definitely led to what's going on now, you know?
Yeah, but I think that's the, well, that's like, I'll tell you, you know who, you're friends with Nick Mullen, right?
Yeah.
So like, you know, like 3 people have told me within the last month how Nick Mullen's their favorite comic.
Yeah, he's fucking hilarious.
I saw him at the Cellar, or no, maybe
the Stand.
This is crazy.
Probably the Stand.
I was so fucking high in New York that I thought that, what's Village Underground?
The VU, yep.
Is around the corner.
Around the corner, right next to the Fat Black Pussycat.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. And the smaller room.
But it looks like the Cellar.
It's the bigger version of the Cellar, yeah.
I thought that they had dug a tunnel and connected connected the fucking two.
They made a bomb shelter in Lower Manhattan
I thought I was at the cellar.
That's so
fucking
funny.
And I was like, wow, man. They dug through. This is amazing. But I saw Nick Mullen there, and he made me laugh so fucking hard.
Yeah, Nick's fucking hilarious, dude.
And I remember, and then randomly, like four or five people kept going, you know who's great? And then, but they were their compliments were like comic compliments.
Yeah, yeah.
They were like,
well, he's definitely a fucking comics comic, because it's like he's like, we have a great, me and Nick are so good at riffing together. There's like a yin and yang thing where it's like, you know, like we just kind of align on what we think is funny. And he's like constantly like the way his brain works and the way like what I provide comedically and what he provides just kind of aligns. So it's like, no one knows like Nick's comedic abilities better than me, because we've been doing, you know, the pod for years together. And he's just like very quick. I mean, there's just like, you're just kind of like, how does his fucking brain work that way? And it's like, you know, it is funny, because like every comic, all of us have some kind of fucking psychological issue where your brain is just compensating. Like, we're all missing something. Yeah. And it's like, he just kind of has that, like, he's like the autistic Terminator, where it's just like, he puts a joke or a person in his sights, and he's going to figure out every little fucking bit that you can come out of that. And he's got a great memory, and it's like, so it's great. It's so fun to riff with him for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's so funny. A comic's brain is so different than a pedestrian's brain. And like, what, you know, like, I can't help. I went
pedestrian
to
is so funny, by the way.
Oh,
like saying that.
I said to a woman the other
day, it's better than civilian. Yeah. That drives me crazy. It's like, we're not in the fucking armed force. Let's fucking relax.
There's a lot of people that overuse that.
They really
civilian.
Do. It's like, we are fucking so lucky we get to do this bullshit. Yeah. Any person on the street, I respect more than even my favorite comic. Let's get that out there. Is that like we give so much less to society than a fucking janitor? But I know you. But there's a reason we're doing it, right?
So it's, I love, someone told me, he goes, yeah, but you know what we do? We give that person that's going through the hardest day of their life, we give them a moment of reprise. Yeah. And I go, yeah, but we also send people through the fucking roof.
Yeah.
We upset people sometimes worse than anyone's ever upset them in their fucking lives.
We never think about the flip side.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we got that one guy that's going through cancer he's like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
But you got that one black chick
who just
stormed out.
Oh,
fuck you.
You've ruined so many people's days. And that's the other thing. It's like, yeah, we do that, but let's stop. Here's the thing that drives me crazy with comedians. It's like, that's not why you do it.
No.
You know what? You do it because it's a lot better than fucking being a paralegal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You do it because you can get rich, get pussy, and just never have to fucking write a spreadsheet again for the rest of your life.
And no one's going to fucking drug test you.
Yeah, yeah, yes, exactly. Sleep in, get fucked up. Let's all relax with the, I just do it to put a smile on someone. No, you did it. At least for me, I did it because when I was 19, this is how I got my dick sucked. And then it's been 15 years and I have no other skills. That's why I do it. And I don't do it. But our brains are, but there's no way. But you're so, and I just watched, because like putting out, you know, I just watched, I was with a buddy who's just I was staying with a buddy who's just a comedy fan, and he wanted to watch Soder's special. He hadn't seen it.
Yeah.
And Soder had a fucking great joke about that, where he was like single mom, a lot of alone time. And I had a dad who chose the bottle over me. And he was like, comedian. He was like, that's the recipe. He's like, why else do you think I'm out here begging for the attention and love of strangers every night?
It's
like,
so bizarre.
That's fucking what it is. You know,
it's like, so bizarre that right now, I feel like I'm not doing anything with my life. I feel like a fucking total loser because I'm not on the road. I'm not doing anything. And I'm like, and I start saying, like, am I going to run out of money? Like,
And
Leanne's like, we're fine.
Gotta
I was
get,
like, no,
gotta
like,
call that private gig back.
Yeah. Fuck. But it's like, I go, it's the weird approval from strangers that I need.
Yeah.
That I'm not getting. And I'm like, the fuck, man.
And it's so fun. It's just like, you know, it's so stupid. It's like if you had just gotten like three hugs at the right times in your childhood, you would just be like a really cool fucking, you'd be like a, I don't know, fucking, what would you even be? That's an interesting question, but you would just, you know, be a cool guy at the fuck, you know.
Selling boats or
cars. Yeah, it's, oh dude, you would be a great, with an account. Like, I got the Peterson account coming in. Can I get some petty cash, boss? You're fucking selling yachts to the super rich?
I would have.
Oh, my God.
Murdered.
Dude, that's so fucking
I would have murdered.
It's so funny because you had that right up. You're so right.
Yeah, like, I would have. I wonder if I would be happier. I think about things, the sliding doors of things, mm-hmm. like, way too much.
Sure.
Like, when we were in... I don't know if, yeah, I can talk about this. But when we were in Serbia,
yeah,
I was running five miles every day.
Wow.
And it got my brain right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I remember one day I'd partied really hard the night before. And one day I went for my jog and I said, you know what? I'm going to jog to the U.S. Embassy because I had a really good time there. I'm going to jog to the U.S. Embassy. And I did. And on my jog back, I pulled my calf. This is a really fucking weird set of events.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I pull my calf. I then go and I get an ice pack. I put it on my calf to go to the go to work that night. Yeah. We're shooting at nights.
Yeah.
I get there. I take the ice pack off and I have burned my calf.
Oh, wow.
The young lady that was
ice
my
burn.
Ice burn, she feels it and she goes, that doesn't feel like skin.
Oh, no.
And I was like,
oh, no.
And so then I go to the doctor on site who doesn't speak English. They have told her that I've pulled my calf, not that I have an ice burn. She puts Bengay on it, icy hot.
Oh, no.
It bubbles into a huge... Oh. She literally puts it on and smacks it three times.
Oh.
And I'm like, that's not what I wanted. It bubbles.
Fuck.
By the end of the night, it's bubbled up.
Oh, my
God. And I'm
God.
Like, fuck. So I have to go to the hospital to get it drained and then wrapped. So then it's drained and it's wrapped.
Your skin.
The next day, we're shooting outdoor
your
stuff.
Your big calf close-up.
No. I can't put a... I'm told not to cover it, right? But I got to wear jeans because that's what I'm wearing in the movie. So they fashion a pair of jeans where you can take the leg off so
like from here up, you see like jeans.
But we're shooting outdoors and we're shooting on a mountain. And we're shooting a scene where I have to fall down a mountain.
Oh, my God.
And so I'm like, all right. So
Jesus fucking Christ.
Dude, I have all this in my head about this.
And how are you going to act?
And I'm not thinking. And I go down a mountain and I go way too hard because I'm worried about my leg.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking about my leg. I fall and I rupture all the tendons
in
my arm.
Jesus fucking Christ.
This is in like a 2-day period.
Oh, my God.
And then... And then because of that, I can't work out anymore.
Yeah.
So I start gaining weight.
Yep.
But we're towards the end of the movie, so you can't tell that
it's
I gained.
Yeah, yeah.
But I had to go come home, get surgery. And because of this surgery, I gained a bunch of weight.
Of course.
And then I thought, and now I'm here, and I'm like, all right, had I not gone on that jog to the embassy, I would have never pulled my leg. And then I'm sitting there at graduation the other night thinking about this. And I go, and I never would have hurt my arm because I would have done the stunt correctly because I wasn't thinking about my leg. I wonder if that would affect.
Wow, this is old stunts. Tom Cruise over here.
Yeah. And I start going through it. And then I think, I wonder, had I not hurt my arm, I wonder if I would have done something even more stupid and died.
So I think about stuff like that
all the time. So when you think about those sliding doors.
Totally.
I remember the phone call I got from Rolling Stone. And my buddy Blair was like, it's for you, it's Rolling Stone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was in the middle of a bong hit. All those things happened to put you on the path of the life you're on.
Of course.
And then I think, like when you say that, I go, I would definitely have I'd be living in Florida. I would live in Florida. I'd probably be a Republican.
That's my friends are.
Like all my friends are Republican.
Yeah, yeah. You'd be like, you wouldn't be that mad if your son was gay. You know?
I wouldn't be cool with it.
Exactly.
I'd probably send him to a Christian camp.
Yeah, you give it one shot.
I definitely.
Yeah, one shot at conversion camp. If you come back gayer, you can stay gay.
And then I go, would I be happier? Because I probably would be in better shape. Because all my friends in Florida all kind of a little more
active. Interesting that you go right to shape.
Yeah.
You know?
I wonder what my wife would look like. Yeah, I know she'd be a dumb whore.
Yeah.
Like, I would never suffer through Leanne. and all these conversations we have to have.
Oh, yeah.
I'd be married to some bimbo, some fucking bimbo with massive tits.
Huge tits for your 30th anniversary. You get them redone.
Oh, I mean, I sometimes when I see bimbos, I go, that could have been mine.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that's what I was supposed to
be. There is definitely something going on in the ether right now. There's a big bimbo movement, I feel like. Because I think my sexual coming of age, there was a lot of Anna Nicole Smith. There was a lot. There was a big bimbo situation. And I feel like there are some girls who now are just kind of like part of the like sexual like liberation things. People being like, you know what? I do just want to be a fucking dumb hot girl. And I'm like, yes. Dude. And you know what? That's good for when you look like a fucking big fat piece of shit. They like being with a successful big fat piece of shit. Bimbos love successful big fat pieces of shit.
I heard someone
oligarch. You know what I mean?
I heard someone say something. Yeah, I need like a chubby guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Dude, I saw women the other night. We were at a big party, and I saw women that I was like, I saw a little girl, like probably 18 years old, mm-hmm. that I was like, do you not have parents?
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah.
What the fuck are you wearing?
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
What? This outfit.
Yeah.
It's akin to a guy in fucking, like, with the tight pearl necklace. And,
yeah, yeah,
like,
sure.
It's like you're going in an angle where we all know where that goes.
Yeah.
And that it ends up. You at a club at 2 a.m. doing coke in Miami, like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you're probably a stripper.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm just
sounds awesome.
Oh God,
good for that. Good for those kids.
I mean, it's funny you see little girls because I've been around little girls.
Of course,
for the past
yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's so funny to see them, and then look at their moms and go, "So that's what that turns
right.
into."
Well, that's the fun thing about like getting old. Like, you know, I'm mid 30s. I'm 33 now, and it's like you realize which loser, like. Which adults you didn't respect, which yeah. ones of your friends are those guys? You know what I mean?
Oh,
when
yeah.
you're like, oh, that's who fucking, you know, oh, Tom becomes this guy. Like that, yeah.
God.
It's so fucking funny to be like, oh, yeah, that guy's just like, you know.
I met a Greek mom the other day.
Ooh.
But like from Greece.
Love that.
And I thought she was Spanish at first.
Yeah, Greek people have a lot. I was just talking about this with my friends because I was staying with my buddy in Glendale. Just nothing but Armenians. And it's so funny that Greeks just snuck into white. You know what I mean? Like we have so much, like we're eating kebabs. Yeah. The music is exactly what Greek music is like. It's just like they're speaking in their language instead of Greek.
Yeah.
We're eating almost identical food, except it's hummus instead of tzatziki. You know what I mean? It's just like, we're so close. And it's like, we're where the line
is. Wait, is that how you say it?
Tzatziki.
It's not tzatziki?
It's not tzatziki. It's tzatziki.
What is the sandwich? Is it gyro?
The traditional is gyro. You know, like think of it as Y-E-E-R-O. But, gyro? You know, it's kind of annoying to be a guy who's like gyro. You know what I mean?
I could
like,
go for some Greek food today.
Oh, yeah.
The best gyro I've ever had in my entire fucking life was in Corfu.
It was
like, we were at this place called the Pink Palace.
Love that.
And it was, have you ever been there?
I've never been there, no.
Dude.
I'll go. I'll check it out.
Let me tell you about this place.
I think I'm going to go later in the summer.
This place is, see if the Pink Palace is still open.
I love, that's just a great name. Love Palace, pink.
Everything's pink.
Alliteration.
All the buildings are pink.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You take a boat over from Bari, Italy.
Yeah.
And you show up, and the first thing they do is they give you a shot of ouzo.
Love it.
And then they tell you, this is back when we went, they say, just so you know, it takes a while for our credit card statements to get back to the United States. So you got about 4 months until these bills show up.
4 months?
So yeah, and so they're like, we take our time with it, so enjoy yourself.
That's just some real Greek business practice yeah. right there. It's, we'll get to it.
This is it. The Pink Palace.
Love it.
Hotel and hostel.
Oh, yeah, hostel. Yeah,
it's
yeah, yeah.
It's run by this guy named Dr. George. I can't imagine he's still alive.
Yeah, or a real doctor.
And, yeah. Or, yeah,
yeah. He's an amateur gynecologist, and he gave himself the title Dr. George.
This place is so much fucking fun.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
You go out to this rock. They take you to this rock, and all they have are lowenbrows. And that's the club.
Yeah, yeah.
So everyone
yeah.
gets to this Pink Palace, and you just live there.
Yeah.
Like everyone's there for like, and there are people there that are there forever.
Yeah.
And it's everyone eats cafeteria style, like they have dinner all served there.
Wait, when were you there? Like
I was there in 95.
Okay.
And So I get there and I see the dudes from the state, David Wayne.
Wow, yeah. Really? Holy shit.
Michael Ian Black wasn't there. Thomas Lennon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They're all there.
That's fucking sick.
And I'm like,
they were hot, right? That was right in the state. Yeah, 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 yeah.
And so, the first thing they do, everyone goes out to eat. You eat. You go to the beach. They take you to this rock. You dive off this rock.
Oh yeah!
And it's just
a lot of rock dives in Greece.
Oh, it's just fucking amazing. And then they come in, and Dr. George has a stack of plates, and he just goes around cracking them over people's heads, and everyone just puts their head in, and he goes smash, and it's the funnest. It's fucking
Greek
time.
People know how to go buck wild. Dude. Breaking plates is sick. We have, making it rain is something rappers and Greek people have in common.
Really?
Every wedding and baptism I've been to since I was 4 years old, old Greek men just fucking throwing singles at the like happy couple. It's just like, because it's like you want to give them money, but you also want to let everybody know you're giving it to them. And my brother just got married. You better believe I had at least $100 in singles ready to go.
Really?
Oh, dude, I was fucking, he was dancing. I was just like he was a hot Cuban with a BBL. I was just hitting him with the fucking ones, dude.
Oh, fuck, I love making it rain. I made it rain on a bunch of Asian kids on Chinese New Year's, and there's love a that. Video of it. And I was like, oh, I'm going to get in trouble for
that's
that.
That's another one that's borderline. Structures of Vietnamese versus Koreans.
I was in all Asian garb. I was
hell
in
yeah.
cultural appropriation, yeah. head to toe. I looked like from Breakfast at Tiffany's. Yeah, is that what it is?
At least you didn't do the eyes.
I go hard on Chinese New Year's. I got 2,000 fresh ones, and that's these kids sick. Came over from this youth group.
Yeah,
and they were doing the dragon dance through the house, scaring the spirits, and then they came out. Yeah, that was God. Me.
The breakfast. That's fucking wild.
That's so crazy.
The teeth are like egregious.
That is so crazy. That.
I mean, come on. That's brutal. Like, that's in a real movie. Like, an iconic, expensive Hollywood movie with the biggest stars in the world. They're like, yeah, you know what? This will be fun. We'll put this. A little
that's
comic
crazy.
Relief.
Crazy.
Mickey Rooney as Mr. Yunioshi. Brutal. Really tough stuff.
That is crazy.
Yeah.
It rain on these Asian
that's
kids.
That's awesome.
And I was like, oh, I'm gonna get lit up for this.
Yeah, yeah.
And they were like, hey, I gave them a tip. I had all ones, and I said, hey, this is thank you very much. And the guy goes, no, just throw it on us.
Awesome.
And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
So they pulled up a chair, and I just started fucking making it rain on them. And I'm like, I'm gonna get in trouble.
They're like, you want to go to the champagne room?
Yeah.
You get sucked off by these Asian teenage boys.
Dude, if I had money back then.
In Corfu at the Pink Palace?
No, this was, I don't know.
No, you're saying.
I have fucking. Oliver Stone was at that party.
Whoa, that's sick.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
That's not, that's the year before. You got to dress in all red.
All red.
And so
Chinese New Year is sick. The dragon, favorite. The red and gold. Oh, it's
fucking
awesome.
Greatest, dude.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So what's the rest of your trip out here look like?
Dude, it's basically done. I mean, I'm going to go do a little more promo. I'm going to try and hopefully see my boy Tim Dillon. We haven't hung out in a while. I'm going to go do a stream. I'm just trying to get the word out for the special. And I got in Thursday. I'm leaving tomorrow. Got to go to Providence this weekend. So it's just like I have 2 more weeks of like intense touring.
Yeah.
And then, dude, that's when the 3 months off begins. And
so what do you got planned for 3 months? I mean, other than the greatest thing in the world is just going back and living a regular life at your apartment.
Yeah.
And being like, and your friends being like, hey, man, we're going to go get drinks tonight. And you're not like, I wish I could. I got a flight in the morning.
There's so much I haven't been like, I feel like I haven't lived anywhere for 9 months because it's like I don't see my friends, like even comedians, like it's like not let alone real friends, let alone regular human beings,
pedestrians,
but yeah pedestrians. So I, yeah, well, actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to, cause like the fucking weight and the health has gotten out of control.
Yeah.
So my brother, hilarious, is like an irony of ironies, is a strength and conditioning coach.
Yeah.
And he's just a sick personal trainer and coach. And I think I'm just going to go to Baltimore, and I think I'm going to fucking spend at least a month just not looking at phones, not doing stand up. I'm going to write. I'm going to try and like engage my brain creatively in other ways, but I'm going to just focus on like health and just kind of try and get back to just like, okay. Like, you know, I'm not trying to lose 100 pounds or anything like that, but I just want to feel good. I want to do something sustainable so that because 2023, I'm going to go hard. I'm going to try and hit, you know, the whole year.
Do world tour.
Yes. World tour. I'm trying to go to London. You know, I love Australia I'd like to have as little winter as possible. So if I could go to fucking Australia in December when it's
fucking
middle
great.
Of summer, that would be sick. So I'm trying to plan it all out. So yeah, Baltimore, just hang out. I have my really good friend is like, she just got married. She's pregnant. Like I want to hang out. It's just like do human being shit, you know? And then also, you know, I don't know, maybe try and be in a real relationship. But that's the other thing. When you're gone, it's just like, you don't even, unless you have a girlfriend who you keep up with, it's like every girl that I was seeing is just like, I check in and they're like, got a boyfriend 2 months ago. I don't live in New York. I'm like, damn, we just talked. And it was like, no, that was 7 months ago.
Yeah.
Like in my head, I'm like, I just saw this girl. And it's like, no, she's engaged now. Like she's not going to come over, get Chinese food and suck you off. Like she's in a committed relationship. So I don't know, dude. It's like this thing of like, I mean, I think it's really interesting because it's like, and my friends who have families and who've had like, whose success has kind of been after they have like established, you know, even at least getting married, at least being in a serious relationship.
Yeah.
For me, it was always kind of like, I love comedy so much and I was so focused and it was the only thing I wanted that it's like, my personal development is a little stunted, right? Where it's like, I never was in, and I used to look at relationships like a hindrance where it's like, I can't have a girlfriend. I have to go do shows. And it's like, I can't do this. I can't do that. And it's like, I'm very lucky. I'm very happy with how this year has gone. I put in the work and it's like worked out for me. But you look around and you're like, well, I'm fucking 33. Both my brothers got married this year. My cousin's engaged. My best friend in the world's pregnant. Like, it's just like, and then you look back and you're like, oh, I'm not, there's no when I grow up, I am grown up, you know? So it's like time to kind of like let the other shit catch up. And so that's why it's like, cause you know, we know all, if you're in entertainment, you know, the people whose constant North Star is success. And they are the least happy people you will ever meet in your fucking life.
By far.
And I don't want to, and I can't even imagine. Like, I have fake internet fame, you know what I mean? And I can't imagine how shitty real fame is, especially, and not that I'm saying I'm going to get that. I'm just saying, like, I don't want to be any more famous. I just want to be happier as a human being. And it's like, if I could just be where I am now, create, you know, do stand-up, tour.
Yeah.
Do, you know, if I want to shoot stuff, want to act, but, like, do it myself. Like, if I could just be at the level I'm at and then just, like, mature as a fucking human being, because it's like, you know, we're all, every comic is 20 years younger in his fucking head than or her head, like whatever sex, we're all fucking immature. And I just want to catch up and just be a fucking guy and also not fucking die, not be like, oh, I'm not, you know, like literally, here's the most embarrassing thing that has happened to me recently. Crashing in my friend's place. I didn't get a hotel this time. I was like, he's one of my best friends. He's helped me with a special. It'll be fun. It'll be like a boys trip. And I'm just crashing in his little pad. He has a pullout couch, IKEA pullout couch. We pull it out. I sleep on it. I'm like, wow, fine. Like, good night. I got an air mattress for him as a present, whatever. And I need to sleep on it. Too fat for the air mattress. I'm just like a hot dog in a bun. Like the air mattress is forming around me.
I know the feeling.
You
know?
Yeah. Who am I talking to?
Yeah.
So the air mattress, I'm like, ugh. My back hurts. I feel like shit. So I'm like, I'm going to sleep on the pullout. Bro, at 3 a.m., I wake up, I hear a crack, and I'm 4 inches lower on the ground. I wasn't asleep. I didn't jump on the couch. I didn't. Just being on it for 2 hours stressed this IKEA pullout so much. I destroyed his couch by being fat. I didn't, by existing, I broke his couch. I wasn't fucking, I didn't take a sledgehammer to it. And I was like, Jesus Christ. I have to check the weight. The weight status on the pullout couches now. And dude, so I'm like, I can't live like this. You know, it's like, I got to change my shit.
I'll one up you.
Okay.
I went through a period at my fattest, which my fattest was 265.
Okay.
And Leanne said,
I'm trying to get there, by the way. I would suck your dick to be 265 right now. 265, I was like, looking in the mirror like, that's a stud right there.
Leanne told me I had to ease myself onto toilet seats. Because I was cracking toilet seats.
Oh, like you're getting into a hot tub.
I'd land on them and they'd crack. They'd crack. And then no one could sit on them because you couldn't see the crack. It's cracked. It's broken.
Yeah.
But when anyone else would sit on them, when you'd go to get up, it would pinch your ass.
Hilarious.
And so I was breaking toilet seats at like a pretty quick clip.
I think I've just subconsciously learned to ease my way onto a toilet seat.
I land on seats. Yeah. I like, boom. I broke couches. Like I fucking land on seats. Yeah. I want to get to like just comfortable. Like I'm uncomfortable. That's where I'm actually not comfortable. Like,
you mean right now?
Like, right now I feel okay, your body, but I haven't eaten what do
you
today.
Mean? Gotcha.
And
gotcha.
So like, but like if I eat,
yes.
Like so that baccalaureate mass.
Yes.
I don't have any double XL collared shirts for whatever reason. First of all, I don't wear a lot of collared shirts. Shirts at all, really.
Yeah.
And so I put on a double X. I had one. It's an XL, but it's a big XL.
Sure.
And I put it on.
Oh, I know all about the big one.
And it was tight on my stomach, like, and I could feel it on my stomach. Yeah. And then that just fucked with me the whole night. Totally. The whole night I was angry at myself.
Of course.
And then I'm burping and farting, and I'm like, and I can't stop
because
I ate the last bowl of ramen before it went bad.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, what the fuck is wrong with
me? Yeah. Yeah. You had to eat your father-in-law's ramen because he wanted butter and sugar sandwiches. Oh. Instead,
I don't know what this is. These don't look like regular ramen. Yeah. I'm like, okay.
Omaha Steaks.
I love Omaha Steaks. Let me tell you something. This has a very personal place in my heart. It's my grandma used to send me Omaha Steaks when I was living in New York to make sure I was eating well. You know why? Because she knew these were the best steaks you can get. This is before anyone else knew about Omaha Steaks. Now, when I walk through the Omaha airport and I see the Omaha Steaks little stand there, my heart jumps a beat and I get steaks because they're fucking phenomenal. Here's a little gift of wisdom from Omaha Steaks. Dad wants steaks. That's no brainer right there. Dads want steaks. And with our Father's Day right around the corner, there isn't a better gift than Omaha Steaks. Visit omahasteaks.com and type Bert in the search bar and order the Dads Want Steaks package. For just $99, this limited time package includes 16 mouth-watering entrees he is guaranteed to love, like smoky tender bacon-wrapped filet mignons, gourmet jumbo franks, and let me tell you, when I tell you right now, those jumbo franks are the best hot dogs I've ever had in my entire life. You will want to order more after you've had just the four, and they're air-chilled, boneless smoked, and they're air-chilled, boneless chicken breasts. My mouth is watering, and for a sweet finish, and Leanne loves these, she buys these once a month. They're caramel apple tartlets. My mouth's watering. I'm getting hungry just thinking about this. As a special gift for my listeners, when you type in Bert in the search bar and order the Dads Want Steaks package, you'll also get 8 free Omaha Steak burgers. These burgers are full of bold, beefy flavors made from 100% Omaha steaks. And now they're bigger than ever at a whopping 6 ounce. Good God, don't wait. Send Dad more than just a gift. Send him an experience he's going to love and he can share with you. Go to omahasteaks.com and type Bert into the search bar and order the Dads Want Steaks package. You will get 16 entrees and 4 desserts plus 8 free Omaha Steaks burgers. Omaha Steaks isn't just a steak. It's the best steak of your life. Guaranteed. That's omahasteaks.com. And the keyword is Bert. But yeah, like that's what I would like to get comfortable. I would like to
totally
like I put on a t-shirt yesterday to go. I really fell off the rails. I do this thing called private suite when I fly out of here, and it's a really nice experience. It's a little expensive, but it's nice because it's a separate entrance to the airport.
Love that.
And so,
what's the point of having money if you can't do shit like that?
Yeah. Oh, it's like, look, I don't fly private.
Yeah.
But I do this. Yeah. And it's just as nice. Totally. It really is. Not just as nice, but
it's great. Also better for the environment. Private jets are tough. I mean, flying in general is horrible for the environment, but private jets, it's really like, we got to stop this.
Yeah, you know? Private jets are ridiculous.
Yeah.
So, having said that, I just bought one for the fully loaded.
And if I could have made the date, I would go back on that statement immediately. Because I would have loved to be on one.
We got a fucking G5 for our run to Rochester.
Hell yeah.
And so I should surprise them, but they're not.
Yeah.
No, if any of them listen to my podcast,
no chance. I don't listen to any comedy podcasts anymore because it's like, I listen to some sports just to kind of like history. Yeah. I like a history podcast.
I like all I listen into is Real Dictators.
Hell yeah,
that's it. That's awesome. My favorite one. And I listen to Rogan. So yesterday we had to take my wife's dad. Him and his girlfriend were flying home, and the private suite was like, hey, you can't really get it for other people because it's a membership. And they're like, looking around this, if you want to come and hang out with him there, we can get you the private suite. And then
he can
be my guest, but you got to hang out with him at least for a little bit. It's kind of break the rules, but whatever.
Yeah.
So we go to the private suite, and then I'm like, and everyone makes fun of like triggers, but I got triggered hard as fuck. So I'm at the airport and I'm nervous flyer.
Dude.
And all of a sudden I'm like, I'm having a drink.
Yeah.
It's fucking 10 o'clock in the morning and I got fucking wasted.
Yeah.
In the fucking morning.
Oh yeah.
And
because when you're in an airport, there's no rules.
I was going to wear it out here and I was like, well, I look like total shit. It's a white shirt. No, I'm still wearing it. It's a white shirt and it baby doll tees on me.
Yeah.
And so
the worst when you're sitting down.
Oh, and
it just scrunches up
the whole time. You're just pulling your shirt down. And then you got this nipple
Yes, the third nipple.
Oh, fuck.
The third fat nipple.
Yeah. My goal today is to not drink.
Okay.
Not drink today.
I believe in you.
And then I was going to not eat also.
That's hysterical.
Yeah.
That's insanely unhealthy.
And just take a Xanax and just put myself under. Just go like, that's it.
Hell yeah, dude. The Dr. Hollywood diet.
I think
who's the fucking gay guy, that Matt Damon movie, the oh my God, I'm blanking.
Talented Mr. Ripley?
No, it's based on a Liberace. Mm. That's how, what you're describing is how Liberace kept his boys slender. He would pill them up and they wouldn't eat. So you're
really?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
You seen that
movie? The Soderbergh movie?
Yeah.
Tom Papa's in that one too. Where it's like Liberace and it's Michael Douglas and Matt Damon. So good.
Oh, it's fucking awesome.
It was awesome. I watched that movie. My mom came to visit me in New York, and for some reason, we picked that movie to watch. It was just such a weird, hey, Mom.
That's okay. I took my buddy. I saw Run, Lola, Run I didn't know anything about it, and I loved that movie. And so what my takeaway was, there's some really cool indie movies. So I was like, all right, well, I'll find out what other indie movie is.
Yeah.
So I grab my buddy Weecho and I say, hey man, we gotta go see this movie. It's called Chuck and Buck. And he's
I've never
like,
seen Chuck and Buck. Oh man.
Chuck and Buck is a story about two friends who Chuck and Buck like to suck and fuck.
You take you and your friend on a solo date to see a movie about two friends that suck each other's cocks.
Yeah.
He's like, hey man, what are you trying to tell me?
and it's like they're basically two gay dudes, and he's trying to hide his homosexuality because he's married, but he's really gay for Chuck. And my buddy Weecho's in a relationship, and in The right as that's they start fucking, so awesome. He looks at me, and goes, "Are you trying to tell me something?"
Said, no. He looks over. You're just harder than you've ever been in your life.
Yeah. What's the story? What's the log line for Chuck and Buck? Chuck and Buck like to suck and Chuck fuck. And that's Buck all like I remember.
That's a great. That's all I need to hear. I'm sold.
Yeah.
Damn. Oh, that's the guy from School of Rock, isn't it? Isn't he? Isn't he playing Ned Schneebly?
And then, well, who's the other guy? Is the other guy that got that famous guy? That's in Parks and Rec.
That's so sick. How much do they show full cock?
I don't remember. I think we got up and left. I think we were like, I was like,
you guys left and you sucked him off in his Camry.
I was like, this isn't what I thought it was. I'm so sorry.
I was saying Adam Driver in my head, and I knew it wasn't the right one. But his name must be Adam, right?
Can I tell you something that I
please do
that I want to edit her name out. Okay.
Okay.
So this lady posted a picture of herself in a bathing suit, mm-hmm. right? And so in a bikini to be exact. Mm-hmm. So I went into the comments, and I had a really interesting moment in the comments where I realized who leaves comments and why people leave comments and how people's comments speak more about, you can of learn course. More about them.
Absolutely.
Cause like, I don't really like, I don't look at my own comments.
Yeah. You can't.
I just don't.
You fucking can't.
Yeah. Cause if you, one bad one just hurts my feelings.
Yes, yes, yes.
And so here was my takeaway.
Okay.
Queen. Sure. I'm not a fan.
You don't like Queen.
I don't like when white girls say Queen.
Well, of course. I think
because it was originally it was meant for black women.
It's every cool part of culture is stolen from black people.
Yeah.
I mean, that's so true. And it's even further back. It's like it starts with like black trans women. And then everybody else steals from them.
Yeah.
And until it finally ekes out. White women are the last ones, but then or the second to last, white men typically are the like, you know. Now even like dads have started saying no cap. You know what I mean? Like
what's no cap?
No cap just means like, you know, like cap is lying. Like basically it's just yeah. like, you're basically like, so if you say no cap, it's like, you know, I got my dick sucked, no cap. You know what I mean? And it's like,
I'm going to start saying that.
And if somebody, cool. See, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Yeah, it's finally gotten to you.
Yeah. So,
it's gotten to like dads with, you know, kids going to college, white dads get cap now.
I got offended. I saw these little white girls twerking
mm-hmm.
in at the top of a mountain in their on their skis, like the whitest, yeah, wealthiest, yeah. most privileged place. And I was watching them twerk.
That's you're so right. A ski resort that their parents paid for by you know
yeah.
working for probably a bank that forecloses on black people's homes.
Yeah.
They're up there. They're twerking.
And I couldn't help but see that they were making fun of it in a weird way. I don't think they understood what they were doing.
Yeah.
But I remember seeing that and I was like, that's not.
The joke, if you really break it down, is like almost like mockery of who would actually behave this way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's also not for you little kids. Twerking is for when did something. That's the other thing with anything from that's a sexual context or yeah. something. It's like once kids get to it, it's like this is fucked up.
Yeah,
stop twerking.
So Queen, I saw a lot of Queen comments.
Yeah,
girl with the URL. You
oh,
go,
dude.
Girl. You yeah. and then fire emojis, and then so many that the phrase Queen mm-hmm. sounded a little bit to me like. That's nice.
Yeah.
You know? Where you're
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Where you're like,
yeah, yeah, yeah. It's become the way everyone was saying my wife.
My wife.
After Borat came out. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so then you get comments that are very negative. Like very negative, you know.
Of course.
My favorite one was a guy who you could tell was trying to be positive because he was had a check mark on him.
And those are the best, the backhanded ones.
No, but he was trying to be nice, but it came out like, you look great, dot, dot, dot. And then he was like, I feel bad for that pool. And then I was like, I don't think that came out the way you wanted it to come out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah, I feel bad for that pool. It's not going to have any water once you dive in.
Yeah. 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 I feel bad for that. I think he meant to say like, he was like, oh, you're so hot. I feel bad for that.
Oh,
pool.
The water. But it, right. came, but it, but still, it came out yeah. like, yeah.
And then you could tell it wasn't good because all the bad people commented under him like savage.
Yeah, yeah.
And
he's
like, not what I meant.
But then
the ones that are negative, you go, there's two types. There's women that are negative, and then there's men that are negative. The men that are negative, I go, you're in ninth grade.
Yeah.
You're afraid
yeah.
that you're never going to find anyone.
Right.
This says more about you than it ever does about her.
Totally.
And then the negative ones from the women, I was like,
or even that you are attracted to this kind of person, but society tells you they're wrong, they're like gross.
Yeah.
So you think by being, instead of being like, fuck that, I think they're hot. You're like, she's a dumb bitch. She's ugly, whatever. Instead of being like, no, this is who I'm into. It's a softer version of how a lot of homophobes just are closeted. It's like, it's kind of like that when you get to people like guys trashing, especially like bigger women. It's like plenty of like bigger women. You, so many guys want to fuck girls that are like bigger.
Yeah.
They're hot. You know what I mean? It's like, but they don't want to admit it because they don't want to seem like a loser for, you know, those popular kids who, by the way, those guys are gay. Like, it's like, you know, it's like those guys, the people that tell you want to be a skinny woman, it's like, you know, there's a reason fashion guys love skinny women and not the people who actually fuck women.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But so that's the men. And then the women.
The women were it's the same type of women that that support men's rights. They're just lost. And then you go and you're like, I'm a buyer for Nordstrom's. And you're fashion vlogginista. And you're like, okay. But the ones that were amazing, and there was a handful of these, were widowed women, overweight widowed women.
Yeah.
Who, and there was like three of them.
Wow.
And that, and
very specific.
I thought, and yeah, and they were like, my husband loved me. I'm overweight. I've had a hard time with my weight my whole life. My husband loved me and kept trying to me to get me to wear a bikini, and I wouldn't. And he recently passed, and I wish that I had your bravery. It was like the coolest fucking like be able to rock your body. But it was
totally
so
but even that's nice, and that sentiment is really nice. But this happens to me a lot, where it's like, dude, you're so cool. How could you look that way and just have so much confidence? And they mean it like a compliment. They're like, whoa, you have so much. But it's like, they're like, how could you in that disgusting, dumpy body come out and not want to kill yourself every day?
Yeah.
I wish I had even half of it. And it's like, all right, let's relax.
Yeah.
Just say I look good. We don't need to, don't tell me how brave I am.
I don't need to know how brave I am. It's like, I never thought
don't
I
tell
was...
me how much just being in my body would frighten you.
Dude, I never thought I was fat. And then when I did my thing shirtless, people were like, it's so brave.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I was like, I look good, bitch. What are you talking about? Same thing with the fucking Sports Illustrated model.
Yeah.
She's beautiful.
She was so hot.
Like,
and if you don't think that girl's hot, then you don't fuck women. I'm sorry. That's the thing. It's like, then you're not actually attracted to women. Like, that woman is like one of the, like, if you saw that woman in person, you would, like, you looked at her face, you would be like, whoa. Like, you would, something would take over you. Yeah, she's hot as shit.
She's hot. I mean, look. No, I mean, I'm not gonna sell Leanne down the river, but
yeah,
I don't know if Leanne could work the cover.
Yeah, she's awesome.
But
that's the other thing. Even that doesn't even feel like real body positivity because they're just picking hot women.
Oh, what did Jordan Peterson say about her?
He said she wasn't beautiful.
What?
Yeah.
No.
I love it. I love
Jordan
that you're
Peterson.
Going,
yeah, for dude, real.
A little too
Jordan,
much.
By the way, Jordan Peterson's looking good these days.
I haven't checked in on how Jordan Peterson looks recently. I
saw him the other day in an interview. I forget where it was, and I was like, "He's looking good. He's had some color on his face."
His thick girl stance has made him a personal enemy of mine.
For real? What did he say? What did he say?
He said, "Sorry, not beautiful," and no amount of what does that say? Authoritarian tolerance is going to change it. Which. What the fuck does authoritarian tolerance doesn't even make any sense.
That girl's mission should be to go out and fuck Jordan Peterson.
No, he doesn't deserve that pussy.
It's so
keep
funny.
Eating roast beef.
It's so funny because like I've been a fan of Jordan Peterson's. Like I like the way he talks. I like the way he thinks. But I think sometimes
it's a little.
I mean this respectfully. He would destroy me in any conversation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he could take what I'm saying about him, and he would annihilate every aspect of everything I am right now. So I'm what? Quit Twitter?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because people were like, "You're a fucking dumb asshole."
Well, first of all, he needs to okay.
Which is like either understand. Troll or don't. He was trolling. He knew what the fuck he was doing.
Yeah.
You didn't think people were gonna be like, "Fuck you, idiot. She's hot."
And he quit Twitter over that? How the fuck did he do that?
That's so funny. People that talk about snowflakes and then do shit like this. It's like, pick a lane, Jordan. Either Jesus. You know what I mean? It's like, come on.
What she look like in clothes? I bet she's fucking smoking in clothes.
Yeah, she's hot.
She's beautiful. We got a beautiful face. By the way, I like her body. I mean, it's not obviously it's not Kathy Ireland, right?
I take her over Kathy Ireland. That's the kind of guy I am.
Oh. Let me rephrase that.
Yeah.
Because I said yesterday I want to come up with a show called Frustrating Hot Chicks. Because when you frustrate a hot chick,
we went to
Jones on 3rd the other day, me and my wife, and we were in a panic. We had this thing and no one was there we underordered food. So we go to Jones on 3rd and we're in line and we're trying to get this done, but it's a big order. And there's this woman behind us trying to get coffee and she is a fucking 10.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But
so hot that I know she hasn't used her mouth to get out of situations often.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So she doesn't have the capability to handle a conversation.
Sure.
Her frustrations just turn into bitch.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And yes.
She was doing
the way a baby starts crying immediately because they've never had to advocate for themselves, you know?
I couldn't said it better. She was getting so upset. And I said to her, I turned around and I'm like, because I'm a guy and I my brain thinks take care of the hot chick.
Of course.
Not my wife.
You're stiff arming your wife.
My wife who's not wearing a bra and still in her pajamas, right? I say to the lady, sorry, we have a big order. And she goes, I'm trying to get coffee. And I went, I understand that.
Yeah.
And I said, but we have a big order, so I'm so sorry. And she goes,
Yeah.
Can someone help me? And I was like, oh, I wanna take this girl.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I want to put her in situations that are out of her grasp.
Any adversity whatsoever.
The worst one I've ever had is Stacey Dash. Is that her name?
Stacey Dash, yes.
Stacey Dash one time took my spin bike. We're at Crunch. Bob from The Biggest Loser was our trainer. And there was one, there were like a handful of good bikes.
Yeah,
we all knew where the good bikes were.
Of course, of course.
And so I get there early. I put my stuff on my good bike. I go over. I start doing sit-ups. I come back, and my stuff is on a completely different bike.
Wow.
And she is now clipped into that bike.
Wow.
And I go, hold on. That's my bike. She goes, no, this is my bike. And I went, no, that's actually my bike. My stuff was on this bike. She goes, no, this is my bike. And I went, no, hold on. And I said, I put my stuff in this guy's and slipped in. He goes, she moved your stuff. And I went, what? She goes, no, I didn't. There was nothing on this bike.
Oh, she was lying.
Yeah. And I go, hold on. That was my fucking bike. And now the class is getting ready to start.
Yeah.
And she goes, just get another bike. It's not a big deal. I said, no, it is a big deal.
Yeah, and you know
it's a big deal because you took the good bike.
You're on the bike.
You're on the bike. You know you wanted that bike. So you get on another fucking bike.
Yeah.
And she goes,
that's awesome.
This is my bike. She kept just saying, this is my bike. This is my bike.
Yeah.
She didn't have any other words.
Yeah.
And I went, no, hold on. And the guy goes, hey, man, you need to get off his bike. You changed bikes. Bob from The Biggest Loser, that Bob, comes in and goes, hey, guys, it's all about positivity. We're about to have a great workout. Just hop on another bike. I go, hold on, Bob. She hopped on my bike. She took my bike. She took my stuff on my bike. And he goes, did you take his stuff off his bike? And she just starts crying.
Awesome.
And I'm like, No, you're not allowed to do that. You have to use words. And I'm like, oh my God, this is why fucking women go missing.
Yeah.
You can't do this. You got to use your words. I can't just cry.
I can't go to
the male equivalent and just start beating the fuck out of everybody.
Yeah.
Like I'm using my words. Right. Don't you go to the fucking.
Yeah.
I was livid.
Taking your stuff off is brutal. She could have made an argument of like, well, you can't save a bike. She could have said she didn't. Yeah. She didn't even try an argument.
Yeah,
she just lied and started crying, which you know.
And then Bob, I got to get Bob from The Biggest Loser on my podcast. That guy was such a great fucking.
That's I could spin absolutely. Teacher.
And he said,
I remember watching The Biggest Loser, a little fat kid, being oh, like, I want to go. I want Bob and Jillian to mold me.
I'm shocked they didn't murder people. Like people weren't just dying left and fucking right. But I want Bob throughout the whole class would just go. He'd be teaching the class. All right, everyone out of the saddle. Let it go. Let it go. It's not worth it. Because he'd see it in my eyes. I'm just staring at it going. Be positive. It's not worth it. And then he clipped out and he walked over to me and he's like, hey, you're here right now. You're done. This is over. Bob is a fucking bad motherfucker. And I don't know why. Because I've never been a pussy hound, right?
Yeah.
Never been a pussy hound.
Right.
But I remember when I found out Bob was gay in class, he said something about, he was like.
Which, by the way, you found out? What are you, are you fucking dumb? Of course that guy's gay.
I had no clue. You know what? I'm the guy that you see in the movie.
Yeah.
Who goes, gay? What are you kidding me?
Yeah.
He's a stud.
Right.
Look
right.
at him.
Yeah, he's the guy ripped. In the Liberace movie who's like, nah, this fucking guy, all those jewels, he gets so much pussy.
Look at him, he's sleeping tattoos. Yeah. Fucking. And he was like, I remember one time he was like, by the way, and I really apologize, Bob, if you're hearing this. But he said something to the effect of, we have a special guest. In the thing today, it's my boyfriend, and everyone cheered, and I went, huh? I remember going like, I think he fucked up. I think he meant to say girlfriend, and I was like, there's no way Bob's gay. And I sat through the whole class. As I was pedaling. I think Bob was like, could you see it in my face?
That's like, so funny.
Yeah, I know. It's making him as a surprise to one of you.
Wow, Bob got your ass.
And I was like, Bob, but man, he was the cool.
Yeah.
And that was like,
that's so
that was, but
funny.
That was a big learning moment. By the way, I was like fucking 30.
Yeah.
So like, let's just point this
you
out.
You can take the boy out of Florida.
Yeah, but man, it takes a while to take the Florida out of the boy. And I remember going up to Bob at the end and being like, but that was like a point where you had to go like, oh, I can be friends. Bob and I weren't friends, but I can look up to a gay guy. I can have a gay guy be my guy that inspires me. And like, it's not.
Totally. And you can be like, damn, it's embarrassing. It took me this long to realize that. But I do now. So let's just move forward.
I remember finding out Tim Dillon was gay.
Yeah.
And I remember he said something. And he was like, it was me, him, and Bobby. We're going to get cigars.
Yeah.
And I said, great crew. And I said, hey, you want a drink? And he goes, oh, I don't drink. And I was like, oh. And I was like, and he said, and I'm gay. And I went, wow, 0-2. And he was like, huh? And I remember being like, by the way, I was 40 when this happened.
Yeah.
But like being like, I can be like, it's a moment where you go, but I'm not a pussy hound. So why the fuck do I care if anyone's gay?
Of course.
I was more bummed that he didn't drink. So I would love to get drunk with him.
Yeah, oh yeah.
I bet he would be the fucking best. Dude. But I remember going.
There's a reason he can't drink because it would probably been so fun.
Oh,
the ripping lines with Tim Dillon.
So
closeted
fun.
Tim Dillon selling mortgages. Probably what you and that guy, that would be a nice night out. Yeah.
I'm going to put this out there and I hope Tim hears this.
Yeah.
I can guarantee you, had Tim and I at our peak in his using and my using, had we ended up selling mortgages together, subprime loans
of
or whatever,
course, yes,
there would have definitely been a night we would have made out. There would definitely, without a doubt, been a night that we made out.
I think so.
Without a fucking doubt.
Yeah. It would have been like you. It would have been like when you and Tim in that situation is like. When a mouse thinks it's playing with a snake, and by the time it's like, I want to leave now, it's coiled.
Yeah.
That would be, you'd be like, wait, I'm kissing him? You'd be like,
I would have definitely made out with Tim. I don't know how I got on it, but there was like a bunch of like trans or gay comics.
Yeah.
I really enjoy hearing people's stories. Like
of course.
It's like the coolest thing is like,
well, that's what, yeah.
It's like, the, it's like, I don't want to hear the same guy do the same shit.
100%. And that's like,
that's why I like Jordan Peterson in the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, I still like Jordan Peterson, but but he was so different than everyone else. And everything was about, you've got to be threatening.
A little too much crying for me. A little too much crying about like the Little Mermaid.
Did he cry?
Like, I mean, he cries all the time.
I don't know enough about these people to talk about them.
I mean, I'm just.
I love that he was addicted to Xanax.
I mean, it's like, okay, you're telling us everything we got to do to get our lives together, and he's in some Eastern European hospital trying to kick pills. And it's like, is his daughter trying to kill him? What's going on?
We were all there. The day we found out you couldn't just stop Xanax all at once, we've all been there.
That is true. Yeah.
But I love hearing different views.
Absolutely. And that's why I think like it's so fucking stupid to fight diversity in comedy, because it's like it makes the show better.
Yeah.
You don't like sometimes like there's it's like I go like, and that's again to keep sucking Bobby off. It's like I'm so grateful that he took me on the road, because it couldn't have been like, you don't want to follow someone who's just a shittier version of you.
No.
You know what I mean? No. Like I was doing fat jokes, and it's like, and like Bobby's a fucking pro, but that's how good he was. He didn't care. He just liked me. But it's like I've started headlining, you know, this year I really hit it hard. And I really was out there, really in clubs. And I used to do little indie shows, little whatever. It's like, but this year was like, I'm really hitting it. And there were some guys who I thought were great guys, but some of these clubs, like they would book people who were just kind of like clearly like liked my comedy and maybe even like knew it and kind of even were mimicking it a little bit. And it's like I don't want like a fun little fat guy to open for me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Give me like a completely different, give me someone with completely different life experience. Give me a fucking, you know, a black Haitian woman. You know what I mean? Give me a lesbian. Give me a gay guy. Give me a trans, like just give me like just an old person. Give me, you know, just like mix it up. Cause it's like, you want different energies on a show and it makes it better. There's nothing worse.
And that's the thing that like frustrated me about that phone call, being accused of being transphobic. I was like, without even knowing me at all.
Yeah, yeah.
And by the way, I'm certain if it's just you look at I know for a fact, you look at my friend list, you can assume that if I'm friends with them, I must feel certain ways.
Right.
But and what sucks too is like there was a guy, you just edit his name out because I don't want anything coming this way. And like he told this fucking hilarious story one time at the store, and it was so fucking good about meeting this guy on Tinder, and then the guy coming over, and then them fucking each other, and then and then the guy robbed him, and it was like such a great fucking story. But he caught him robbing him, and it was awesome. It was such a cool story.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know that guy does not like me. I know that person does not look at me and go, "Oh, it would be cool to run into Bert," you know, because I look the way I look.
I mean, you know, it's like, it is tough, because the one thing I do really love about comedy is that like at the end of the day, like I am bonded to people who just are funny.
Yeah.
And it's like, that is true. Like, and maybe to a fault sometimes, like maybe I do let certain things slide because like, this is my kind of person. Like comedy matters to me. What matters to me is being funny. And it's like, you can have friends where it's like, there is no reason other than this common thing that you guys would ever hang out. And I think that's actually really fucking the beautiful thing about it, where it's like, we love this thing so much and we want to understand it the same way. And it's like, yeah, we've got differences, and it's like, you can slowly kind of get to know people that way. And yeah, I mean, I try, it is hard. I think like if people kind of pigeonhole you one way or another, I mean, I think it's definitely harder for, you know, people that aren't as represented for them to get pigeonholed, but it's like, it's hard because you're just like, wow, let's just be comics. Let's fucking hang out. And I like that. I mean, I try and do that though. I mean, a lot of my friends, I try and like, you know, I like alt rooms. I started in clubs, but I was in alt rooms. I like, you know, just put me anywhere. Just let's try and make people laugh. But it is, you know, I do like that though, because I think that is a way in, right? Even if you have big differences with someone, we all love stand-up.
Anyone that gets on stage, immediately, me and that person have shared so many experiences.
So true.
We have so many connectings.
Yeah.
And you know, there's people that would argue, it was harder for me, Bert. I was a woman, you know.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, maybe they're right.
Which
they're
is
right
true.
About that.
Yeah. You know, like just, if yeah. you're, if I mean, still in the industry, it's like you look at how many women, like just look at who headlines places, and it's like the numbers are fucking. It's starting to change, whatever. But it's like the numbers are a little too. And you do meet, like, I mean, in this business, you do meet club owners who are still sexist, who are still like wildly yeah. homophobic, all this kind of shit.
Wildly,
so, yeah,
wildly
homophobic. You got some old school people, but yeah. But it is nice to fucking be able to, you know, just connect with people. And then also it's like, you know, when you start popping, you get to change that and you get to like put other people on that you think are people need to see, you know, which yeah. is another cool part about comedy that, you know, like I said, I always appreciated what Bobby did for me, Tom Papa. And it's like, you know, I'm not there yet. I still feel like I need to establish my career, but you know, even with you putting on the fucking, all the tours and booking these like cool lineups, it's like, that's awesome. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like getting people that other people aren't aware of or your fans in front of them. That shit's cool. And I think that's how you have an opportunity to probably like bond with people that you might not have that much, you know, in common with or something.
Yeah. I got, when we did a tour one time and someone said, like, it's really cool, man. You know, how you make sure everyone's represented on your tour. You got like couple Latino guy, and I was like, oh, I don't see
that. I've never thought about that.
Yeah, once.
Yeah.
Never once have I ever seen like Brian Simpson's.
You don't
doing,
have a checklist.
Brian Simpson's doing Fully Loaded. Not this is a wild thing to say.
Yeah,
definitely not because he's black.
I don't know. I saw your checklist. I saw your who to book checklist. You're like, we're light on broads this month.
Dude, we have more women on Fully Loaded than I think we do men.
Yeah.
I mean, but Brian Simpson, he did my podcast and his brain is so fucking smart.
Yeah, yeah.
The way his brain, like,
and yours
is better than
the
just
the way you just said that.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Mine's not. Mine's definitely not.
Brain, like, good thinking.
Oh, by the way, it's not. We just have three women.
Yeah,
but it seems like a lot,
four,
right?
You got four.
Who's the fourth? Oh, yeah. My fucking brains. We got a lot of white men.
Yep.
Three white men.
Sal, we're not sure what he's got going
Sal's
on.
Sal's Cuban and Guatemalan.
Italian name, but...
Brian Simpson's funny as fucking
shit. Oh, yeah,
shit,
that guy's hilarious.
But not just funny.
His Netflix is really good. I don't know him personally, but
his,
very funny.
He's not just funny. He's smart as fuck. Like just the way he can eloquently say something that comes out racist.
Yeah, you're really blowing
it. No, but like Chappelle, you know, take a moment and put it in words
that you
can very easily wrap your head around.
Yeah.
And it's like he's got a real ability to fucking sizzle down a moment and explain it back to you. And you're like, oh, that's more than, that's a brilliant comic. But that's a brilliant thinker.
Yeah,
like
communicator. Really great communicator.
Really great.
Yeah.
But, dude, I appreciate you doing this. We've been going for fucking 2 hours.
But it was fucking fun, dude.
Yeah,
we really could keep going.
I could do, anytime you're out here, please.
Thank you so
anytime
much.
Anytime you're out here, please.
I appreciate it. Yeah, and please, guys, check out the special Live at the Lodge Room on my YouTube channel. And just subscribe to the YouTube channel. And, you know, I'm out on tour. I'm taking the summer off, but I'll be back in the fall. And then a big one. 2023, and I'd love to, man. Anytime.
Come out before you go out for the fall. Come out.
I will definitely do
and
that.
Promote the dates and whatever.
I definitely will, dude. Thank
dude,
you so much.
I love you, man.
Love
Thank
you, dude.
You.
Appreciate it, dude.
Fuck
Thank
yeah.
you.